doing I'm doing a variety of things.
Economic development guy, if you want to just go say hello.
Hi, Conrad. It's a thrill to drill. You've been through this before. The last time you came, it was a big pressure.
Just start up here.
I know.
You know,
well, because they forget about that business. That's what they do. They forget about that early. That's all it is the early start.
Just make yourself.
And so, the only reason I try.
Members are happy.
You want to start a side?
If they can do well, that's. I think 5:30. Now they have a new location.
Our town meeting.
They have a second location. It's not. Well, no. I want to put them on earlier and save the liaison for the end. That's what I'm thinking. I mean,
school committee appointment. Is that a hearing? I don't think so.
The vacancy is posted. That's.
Where's my plug? They do take it out.
Is that you, the white guy?
Yeah.
Oops.
Yeah. Let me see here.
You
got a lot of notes
here.
Plug
it's always here. Oh, it's in my clipped stuff. That's
right. I'll just use it over here. We don't have to pull it up.
Where's it come up from?
It usually comes up.
Suburban Coalition.
Well, they didn't send us anything. We're getting numbers.
Oh, sorry. Really?
Got it? Thank you.
Thank you.
I sent the draft.
Okay, folks. Showtime. Here we go. Let's start the liaison reports. John, got anything?
Nothing to report, John.
Okay. Kevin.
I was attended the, and they're going to be here, I believe, for us later on today, the last ZBA meeting, which had Reading Village come in, and this was a point there where they had to go through the draft waiver motions.
Mm-hmm.
So I think everyone's had a chance maybe to see Dan, that you sent that around earlier. Yeah. Essentially what came out of this meeting was that there's certainly a lot of things that the ZBA was comfortable with giving waivers on to this group. One of the bigger things is something that's going to be coming before us tonight, kind of ties into it, was parking. You know, parking continues to be right around one spot or just barely over one spot, I think, per unit, and there is still a lot of concern in regards to that, with what effects that's going to have on the neighborhood, in regards to not just the tenants being there, but also their guests coming and going, where those cars are going to be staying. So that's been a continuing theme. It's been I think the biggest piece to this whole project has been parking. So.
So just as a point of information, I know they're coming.
Yep.
Maybe I missed it. Did any of you get anything from them telling us why they were coming?
Nothing beyond the two-page summary, but that was from our staff, I think.
Yeah. No. I mean, so in other words, we've got nothing from this developer.
Right.
I mean, I just want to make sure it wasn't just me. I would understand if somebody excluded me, but
is this just an informational visit?
That's my assumption. No one's told me anything either.
What's our role in these waivers?
I assume you're going to listen. You have no role.
Can we recommend to the ZBA.
Well, you certainly can, and they can either agree.
Well, Kevin is saying that he believes that their purpose in coming, based on what you heard, was that they have some interest in parking, which of course is us.
The road commissioner.
You know, we're the road commissioners. So I just find, I mean, I'm, and I know you've been on top of this all the way, Kevin.
I talked to them about it.
Why they don't.
I talked to them about it, and I'm surprised that, you know, they didn't send anything across, quite frankly.
I'd feel much better if there was a proposal that we could talk about. If it's just a round table, I don't know how, it's like trying to squeeze a balloon.
You know, I wonder if they're coming in to, you know, essentially see what the tolerance for what they're looking for would even be before bothering with the proposal.
Are they coming to see if we're going to be nice to them?
So what they're coming.
We'll find out.
What they're coming for is they want to have a loading zone essentially on the front.
Right.
One of the waivers, I should say, to back this up, that was declined was you have to have one loading unloading spot on site per 20 units when you have these developments. So that waiver was declined by the Z, or I shouldn't say that. Excuse me. As part of the draft document, they are not going to grant that waiver outright to let them not have less than one spot per 20 units. The ZBA, though, has said it's just the kind of the way they have to go about it. They'll have to kind of decline that part of the waiver, part of the draft. However, they would be amenable to allowing them to only have one on site for the entire development.
If two others were located on the street.
No. They're actually, the ZBA is not. Again, this Julie, correct me if I'm wrong. They didn't seem to be saying we want to have two or three. They seem to be saying we want to have it on site. And if you only can have one, we'll take that.
I thought you said you needed one per 20, which is minimum of three, maybe even four, depending on how it's.
We also need 1.5 parking spaces per unit as well, too, which we don't have.
But it is a constructive waiver of the requirement for one per 20.
That's correct. Right. So that if they can't get it on site, what they're coming for us to tonight, I feel like, is to see what is our tolerance to say, can we put this on the street and then include it as part of ours?
So Kevin, is there a trade-off between the number of loading zones and off-site and on the parking? So if it's on site, that constrains the number of parking spaces that they have.
It takes them under one space per unit.
Right? That's why. They just want to get over mathematically.
Yeah, so I didn't mean to open a can of worms, but it just struck me odd that I know you were there. I know there was a ZBA. I know they're coming. But, you know, normally when somebody's, you know, coming to visit, they let us know what it is they want to talk about. So I guess I'll ask them.
I was going to say, they can certainly speak for themselves. The tone I got from the board, it seemed that every board member was saying they want to have it, the loading spot that they're coming for us tonight, the applicant, they want to have it on site. It seemed to be that, you know, again, they're going to be here tonight, so they can certainly speak for themselves, but that was the tone.
I wasn't trying to, you know, come after you. Quite the opposite. I know you've been, you know, deeply involved in.
Happy to give out information. That's what I got.
Given the letters that we got from a lot of the neighbors, I'm assuming there'd be some neighbors coming. And what I would not want to see is have litigate the whole issue at the Board of Selectmen when the developer's here and the neighbors are here, and there's no, you know,
Well, I mean, the neighbors have told us more about what it's going to be than they have. And, and we'll get to the bottom of that. So, Dan, you had something?
Yeah. I have a question on the number 28. I'm looking at your draft agreement. Off-site parking arrangement. Is there any such negotiated off-site parking arrangement at this time? Can you tell us what's under discussion?
I suspect Kevin might know more about that than I do.
I do know that I think at suggestion, Bob might have been on.
It's not on
suggestion.
Street. You're not talking about that, are they?
No.
No, they did. I think they did enter into talks with the MBTA, the lot that they have down the street, to see if they could rent, lease, buy, utilize that spacing. I'll let them answer exactly.
It seemed
like that, you know, they were discussing that with them. I don't know if they had a conclusion in regards to that. Should say they don't have a conclusion. I don't know if they have a direction as to is the MBTA willing to, you know, grant them that kind of.
This isn't the same lot we got a bill after 5 years on, is it?
Could be. That's different but related.
Well, this is going to be fun tonight. I can see that. We get right
there was,
off.
I should say, there was a comment made in the audience that, boy, you should really move this to the Pleasant Street Center tonight. I said, oh, it's a little too late for that. We're already posted.
No, can't do it. Barry, liaison.
Yes, actually, Kevin and I attended the Chamber of Commerce breakfast, I think it was last week, at what used to be the old Aroma Cafe, what's it called?
Fusion
Cafe. Why don't we call it the Fusion Cafe, yes.
Give the new owner his due.
Yeah, and he did a great job, by the way, a great breakfast, and the Chamber brought in, I think it was...
retail.
Yeah, the head of the National Retail Association.
Oh, cool.
Massachusetts. Who came in and gave a talk sort of about just general retail issues in general. And actually, one of the things that he did, he kind of gave a big shout out to the town of Reading about how great our downtown is and how well it flows. And, you know, he's been to downtowns and, you know, hundreds of cities and towns and was really impressed with the work that we've done here, which was great to hear somebody from the outside say it and acknowledge it, which was, which I thought was really important. You know, they gave an update of sort of the national issues that are affecting retail, as well as some of the statewide issues. Bob was there as well. We talked about some of the initiatives we're doing here locally. So I thought it was a really good meeting, well attended by a lot of business community, which I think will segue a lot of what we're going to talk about tonight. And then the other thing I would just like to talk about briefly is I think most of us were at the Veterans Day, and I really want to just compliment Chairman Halsey on the speech that he gave. Really touching. It was a great ending to an incredible event, which ended with a pinning of a 98-year-old veteran, his bronze star that he was a survivor of the Bataan Death March, and finally got his medal in front of the entire town. So
that was impressive.
That was really, really brought tears to your eyes. And John, you did a great job. And I just
thanks for bringing that up. You actually did. You did really do a great job. That was a great speech.
Amazing.
I'm glad you made it through it.
And kudos to our other favorite, Kevin Bowmiller, our veteran.
Yes.
Who pulled the whole thing together.
Thank you.
Great breakfast.
Is doing an outstanding job for our veterans. I spoke to a veteran in the audience who said Kevin was instrumental in getting him a long-sought hearing aid. That he'd been experiencing a lot of red tape obtaining, but that Kevin was able to help him out. I'm sure there are a number of other stories just like that. The only other thing I have, and I don't know if this was forwarded to everybody, there's a meeting of a group called the Suburban Coalition, which is it's a group of boards of selectmen, school committees, and FinComs who, in previous meetings, passed the Suburban Coalition resolution for full funding of the Foundation Budget Review Commission's recommendations. And they are inviting us to join them as they plan their next steps. The meeting will be held Wednesday evening, November 30th, at the Newton Marriott. Most people know where that is, 7:30 to 9 p.m. So if any member of the board is interested in going, I'm going to see if I can make it.
I'm going to take a ride.
All right. Very good. That's all I have.
Bring up these issues in front of people who think like us.
I do want to play off of something you said, Dan. Kevin Bowmiller is really doing... great job with our veterans. You know, it's just kind of, first of all, it was just the couple of hours that breakfast was going on was a lot of fun talking to people. And he really, you hear from each and every one of those people, they comment on how he knows them and how he, you know, he looks after their needs. And you know, I mean, it was lightly brought up to him that there was a Reading resident that was 98 years old and had never gotten his Bronze Star, and he just went into action. And it was really something to understand that, you know, how much work he puts into it that I think is above and
beyond.
Did I
hear correctly that citation was formally awarded in 1962?
Yeah.
And he must have done a lot of digging to find the right people.
Yeah, there was nothing simple about it.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
It was a lot of work, and he does that on a regular basis because I hear from veterans about, you know, the kind of the group discussions he organizes and the energy he puts into things that come up for them, you know, whether it's helping them find a medical device that they need or, I mean, this 98-year-old man who lives in this town was sitting there with his wife of 67 years, and we were able to, you know, award him that because of Kevin's work. That's enormous to me. So, that's all I got. But let's open it to public comment. Anybody ready to roll yet? You're just kind of getting ready. Yes, Bill.
Just to add on to that, Kevin's trying to get him the purple hat too.
Is he?
Excellent.
Yes.
I thought he had it. I thought he got it.
No, he didn't. There's a couple other medals in his promotion. Mm-hmm. He never got it.
I knew that the promotion was something that was perking in the background. So, any other public comment? Bob.
Just one. Thank you, John. We set a land record for speed last night at town meeting. 19 articles.
Outran our coverage.
Did we attend a Reading town meeting?
We should threaten to go four or five weeks with every town meeting. I think that's the key here.
The
wow.
I think that was good.
Up on the screen is what is left. It's been an interesting town meeting to try to plan. But just so the community is aware, on Thursday night, there appears to be a reconsideration of Article 16, which was the Oakland Road property. And then there was some previously scheduled speakers that could only come in that night, plus Articles 19 and 23 that were tabled to Thursday. And then we just roll into the regular agenda for as long as town meeting will stay, including zoning articles. Then next Monday, we specifically address both special town meetings, and it's our expectations that's all we'll do that night. But if there is time for more, we'll continue back to the subsequent town meeting. So I just wanted to explain where we are, and especially for town meeting members that came last night expecting the high school TLT litigation to be discussed. That's now scheduled for next Monday, I would guess at approximately 7:45 to 8 o'clock, if that schedule holds. And we'll know that at the end of the week.
I predict you'll get both done in one night.
Yeah, I think so.
Be able to move on from there.
So, is that the end of the articles that we need to take up? That's amazing.
Yep, and
I really do think you have to announce at the beginning that we have the hall booked until December 22nd.
Reverse psychology.
This was definitely the threat, is listing all these possible meetings. I had a couple comments about that at the end of the night. Thank you for scaring me and being quiet.
But the work got done. That's good.
Yep.
So Bob, you have more?
No, that's all. Thanks, John.
Do we need to discuss anything about the article that's going to be revisited?
No, there is a motion that you should still carry forward today to declare Oakland Road surplus for the same reason the school committee should have done it, regardless of what happens at town meeting. My understanding of the reconsideration is that, if you will, there were two parts of the article that were, it was an 85 to 55 vote, not quite two-thirds. It was 10 votes short or something.
Yeah, 10
like
votes
that.
Short, yeah.
Some of them didn't understand that there were two parts, I'll say. They just thought it was selling the land. But the first part is to legally clear the title. Mm-hmm. And that's important. Now, it doesn't have to be done this Thursday, but it should be done at some reasonably soon time. And then the second part of that, if you will, was to give the selectmen the option to sell the property.
But they could be separated, is what
Absolutely.
You're saying.
Right.
Yeah, and they could have been separated, obviously, in advance or even on the floor.
We probably weren't thinking of it. You know,
I wasn't thinking about it. No. I had never heard any negative comment until the floor of town
meeting,
which is unusual.
Yeah. I think it took us all by surprise in that I think any one of the five of us would have gotten up and said, hey, this is what we're trying to do. But it just went so quickly.
Well, shame on us. We should have jumped up. Yeah. When you say sell, Bob, you mean
disposition
in any manner that the public or the board elects to do.
Right. So but it doesn't even have to. It could be a lease. It could be a sale. It could be let's keep it and do this other
Correct.
Thing.
I think the important point to make is, yes, we're going to have a process going forward. We hear you. We don't want to authorize the sale until that process is completed. However, in order for that process to really properly get underway, we need to clear the title.
Really hard to explain to somebody you might be able to do something if you don't have the right to do it,
So the mechanics are the two steps. I think this has to be the first article of business by the charter.
Yeah.
Moderator will bring, there's been a motion filed to reconsider Article 16. Either Glenn Hartzler is the town meeting member who made the motion.
And that's two-thirds to vote for reconsideration.
And then I think under that first discussion, the moderator should entertain the scope of what will be presented should they vote to reconsider the article. If the reconsideration part passes, that essentially vacates the motion that was voted.
The original motion.
and a new motion that can then be substituted, which is under the original four corners. So a lesser scoped motion would be in order, and that's what we will offer. Barry's offered to spearhead that discussion.
So is that done at a as an amendment to the?
No, you reoffer the motion.
Okay.
Once reconsideration vote takes place, and that has to get 2/3, by the way.
So
or it stops there.
But, okay. But the changes that are proposed, if any, are contemplated, how would they get introduced? Immediately.
A new motion.
We if you don't mind, town council sent me a revised motion today. Honestly, I didn't even read it yet. I know what it's going to say. That's then the default motion on the floor, which we'll hand out to everyone in
so
advance.
So it'll replace the motion.
It would replace the
Monday
night motion.
Okay. It's as if it never happened. The vote never happened.
So the two steps are, first of all, to see if town meeting is willing to vacate its original decision.
Right.
And if they are, through a reconsideration process,
right.
Then an amended one that sounds like it's, you know, I mean, I don't find that at all a bit of a problem,
yeah.
You know, and it sounds like it matches the appetite of town meeting.
But both do require 2/3.
Yeah, but I think by keeping the front half of that,
right.
Now we become custodians,
right.
Not salespeople for that land.
Yep.
And then, you know, you see where it goes and what happens.
I mean, it doesn't require us to dispose of the land. It just allows us, to enter
right.
into the conversation.
The right, but not the obligation.
Yeah. But
and I think people were kind of like
right.
not ready for
I
that
I think that was part of the confusion. Right?
Yeah. That's fine. You know, that's probably, I mean, it did kind of sail through. A lot of stuff sailed through so fast that, it, you know,
let's
it's not its usual time that you have to think about everything that's being said. It just was kind of moving. So. We'll work on
yep.
seeing where that goes next. So, Paul, there's no proclamations or anything like that, certificates of appreciation tonight. I think we ought to get cooking here with the economic development update. Ready to roll?
Hello.
Welcome back.
You?
We're glad
Thank
to have you.
You
here.
Thank you. It's exciting. I'm excited. I'm excited to show you what I have. Set up here. All right, so as some of you know, through reading through your packets, I've been hired back to work on this project related to economic development and sort of in connection with the hiring of our new economic development coordinator. But this piece of the project, we are really looking at identifying best practices from our peers. So what we're calling this project is Peer Community Best Practices, Foundations for Economic Development. I'll just go ahead and jump right in. So tonight we're gonna cover our recent economic development efforts, project overview of this specific project, information and data sets that I'll be collecting, some information, mostly socioeconomic and demographic information of our peers, looking at our peer community survey that we sent out a couple months ago, some initial thoughts on that based on the information we've received back. Some ideas moving forward with this project, where do we wanna go, how do we wanna process all this information? And then we're gonna talk a little bit about growth. We're also going to include a case study with Wakefield. And then we really want to just briefly talk with you all to see what we're missing, what else should we be considering with this project that we haven't thought about yet. So most recently we've done the Economic Development Self-Assessment Tool, which is known as the EDSAT, and the Economic Development Action Plan. And just to briefly remind you of what those are, the EDSAT was completed in 2014. It really evaluated our strengths and weaknesses as it relates to expanding economic opportunities in Reading. It really identified how Reading scores on various criteria that are important to location specialists, thinking about moving to Reading, and helped us identify where we can improve on those criteria. More recently, we've done the Economic Development Action Plan that was completed in 2015. It evaluated our opportunities in the four regionally significant priority development areas. It really looked at the market potential for those sites and what those sites could really support based on market conditions, market needs and site conditions. One thing to note from that plan, that in addition to a really strong residential market that we have, there is a projection for at least 16,000 new office-like positions in the area and an opportunity for us to grab 15,000 to 30,000 square feet of new office space in some of the larger PDA sites. And in addition to that, 9 new restaurants and 6 new retail opportunities. So we really need to start thinking about how do we fill that market need here in Reading with such a competitive market with our neighbors, Burlington, Woburn, places like that. So that was one thing the plan was very adamant about, was just the competition in the area and how do we really grab that into Reading.
Are we looking at bigger projects like a potential research park? Should we find enough land or areas to redevelop? Is that in the cards?
I think really what, well, we have our priority redevelopment areas, which we have been identified. But yeah, I think really we need to look at all the opportunities.
Yeah.
So this project specifically is going to establish a framework of comparing Reading to our peer communities. How do our peers approach community development, and what can we learn from the information and the data that we gather? Some key questions that we're going to be asking are, what are their objectives in community development? How do they measure community impact? Do they measure community impact? And then how does their town government impact community development? Are they regularly involved in chamber meetings? Do they have an economic development committee? Do they have economic development staff? How does town government impact government community development? We'll also be looking at tax information, community characteristics, and visual documentation through site visits. So when we actually start looking at the data, we kind of have these little areas of data collection. We have infrastructure, economic development planning, beautification, the government regulatory side of things, and open space that we really want to delve into and see whether or not any of this data ties back to community and economic development. We all know that certain things can be an impediment to development and that they can actually really support growth. For example, infrastructure. Does the community have water and sewer availability? Do they have wayfinding? Is that a factor? Government and regulatory, permitting. Do they have a streamlined process? Do they have a lot of special permits? Website presence is huge. Do they use their website to attract developers? Do they have business permitting guides or flowcharts on their website? When it comes to economic development planning, do they have incentives? Do they have programs? Are they readily available on their website? Things like that we're really going to be looking at, gathering that information and seeing what our peers are doing and what's working, what's not. So who are our peers? Here's the list and map of the communities we are looking at. For this particular project, we've added Melrose into the bucket. So there are 26 communities we are looking at.
When it says deemed in the upper left corner, how and who?
About 5 or 6 years ago, our first consultant did a lot of statistical work, demographic work,
right,
socioeconomic, and came up with 23. And then our most recent consultant agreed with those and added 3 more through, I think, slightly less rigorous statistical work, I'd say.
So I'm just going to quickly walk you through some demographic, socioeconomic information just to give you a flavor of how we compare to these peers. What you're seeing here on the left is population in general, and on the right is population density. There's really no surprise here in terms of density. The higher you are, the closer you are to Boston, the denser the community, and the further away you get, the less dense. Reading is sort of in the middle there in terms of density. Compared to our peers.
So just, is that line going across, that's sort of the average? So
that's actually representing where Reading stands. So you'll see that bar, that's the Reading bar. Looking at household incomes, Lexington is observed to have the highest of all the peers, followed by Concord and Winchester. The lowest is observed in Stoneham. Reading is somewhat in the middle here with 103,000, which is just above the average of 102,000. We also looked at home sales. Right now we have showing home sales for 2014 and 2016, which go to September of this year.
This is the average, or is it the?
Average.
So it's the total sales divided by number of sales.
Yes. So what we are observing is the highest home sales in Belmont, Concord, Lexington, and Winchester. It's not really surprising. They're shown to be the highest in all years. Danvers is the lowest in 2016, and by low, 419,000 is still pretty pretty high. You know, in general, the residential market in this area is really strong. It's growing. The average in 2016 was 603,000. Reading was just under that at 544,000 for average home sales.
Average price of
price of home sales, correct. So we also looked at the tax rates. On the left, we have commercial industrial tax rates for FY15 and residential tax rates for FY15 on the right. The highest for commercial and industrial are observed in Dedham, Wilmington, Bedford, and the lowest is observed in Winchester and Belmont. And then on the residential side of things, the highest is in Milton and North Andover, as well as Westboro. And then we have the lowest in Burlington and Winchester. We will have a little bit more on this topic a little bit later in the presentation.
Rather than look at tax rates, would it be more useful to look at tax, average tax bill? The rates are normalized by the value of the property. So Winchester's got a lower rate because the property values are so elevated, you don't need much of a rate to pick up what they can.
Yeah, we certainly do have that data, and we will be incorporating it into.
It's just counterintuitive, right?
Yeah.
The guys with the lower rates, you'll.
It's actually a really complex question. If every assessor were the same,
if all the other things,
then you'd have
equal.
One answer. But every assessor has an arc.
Right.
So.
Right.
What a business typically looks like, and I don't want to get into it, isn't it's the rate, if they even care. They have no idea what their assessed value will be once they buy something and change it. So that's something you can ask the paper later.
This slide is actually looking at some land use information. We have commercial industrial land use as a percentage of total developed land. And really what we mean by total developed land is looking at residential land, commercial land, industrial land, and what percentage of that is commercial and industrial. Danvers is showing the highest in this category, and Concord is also showing really high, and I'll explain that with the next slide. And the lowest is in Milton, Reading, Belmont, and Shrewsbury. So I always like to look at satellite imagery, but what's interesting with these is Danvers and Burlington on the left, you see a lot of gray, and that's very you know, consistent with high development. If you were to zoom in really close, you would start to see that a lot of that is commercial and industrial development. Concord and Westboro, on the other side, they are showing a high amount of commercial and industrial land, likely because they actually have a lot of undeveloped land, which isn't being counted in the denominator. So Westboro, especially if you zoom in, they do have very specific pockets of industrial areas and commercial areas. So when we look at the lowest commercial industrial land uses, total developed land, Shrewsbury, Reading, Belmont, and Milton, these satellite images really look like there's a lot of developed land in these communities. But looking at it further, it is a lot of residential, almost all residential. And so when I took a look at their zoning maps, it's pretty consistent with what they have zoned. Very little areas zoned for commercial and industrial uses. So we looked at the tax levy as a percentage of the budget, and Concord receives the highest tax as part of its revenue from all the peers. Mansfield, Shrewsbury are the lowest, and Reading is at 60%, which is below the average of our peers at 66%, likely due to the higher educational state aid and, you know, the below average property taxes. So just
that's an interesting comment.
Yeah. So
say that again.
That we're raising,
yeah, why don't you
less
say that
of
again
our money.
Let's talk about that for a second.
Yeah.
We discussed that during the listening sessions, that Reading at 60% derives a lot less money from taxes,
yeah,
than an average peer community. And part of the reason, as Jesse said, is we have a lot of kids, so we get more state aid than a typical town would for education. And the the other is statistically our tax, our average single-family tax bill is below average for the peer communities. So however you want to describe that, our taxes are not high.
But this is the levy, so another contributor is that we haven't gone through the same override frequency as some of our peers.
True.
So the fact that we've been restrained.
That works into the average tax bill, if you will.
This is the levy, not the average bill. This is the aggregate.
But the levy does include inside the levy and excluded. It's not just inside the levy, I apologize. It's property taxes total.
Total property taxes.
So it includes the high school.
So does that mean we're relying on other sources?
Yes.
Other than taxes to meet our budget needs?
Correct.
And the question is, why is that? It could be that we're really good and parsimonious and we draw money from all the sources we can. Or it could be we're really good at keeping the levy. We're not going for overrides as frequently. There's a bunch of contributors to it. It's not one-dimensional. It's really fascinating.
Probably not well understood.
Yeah, it's around that one.
That was pretty apparent during the listening sessions.
So, as I mentioned earlier, we did send out a survey to our peers, the leaders in our peer communities. We sent that out the end of September just to really open the dialogue with our peer communities. We asked them 11 questions in addition to someone we can contact to follow up with. A couple of the big questions were, you know, what do they consider their top three issues which drive community development goals? How do they measure the success of projects resulting from those goals? We asked them, have they streamlined their permitting process? If so, how? Do they offer any incentives to attract and retain businesses? So far, we've heard back from 15 of 26 communities, and we are trying to follow up with those 15 in person, have in-person interviews, and I've had a few already, and I still have a few more to go. Some of the response highlights that we have, over half of those who responded said that balanced growth and promoting economic development and expanding the tax base were on the top of their three primary objectives for community development. Interestingly, many of the respondents indicated that a pre-application meeting with developers was one of the ways that they've streamlined their process. We do that here in Reading with our DRT, so I just thought that was interesting that a lot of communities are trying to incorporate that into their process. And then when it comes to challenges of economic development, many of the respondents indicated that lack of developable land or land that's not appropriately zoned as one of their biggest challenges, in addition to infrastructure challenges. So we don't necessarily have that particular challenge, but lack of developable land is similar. So some of the next steps that we'll be doing, we're going to continue our data collection on the peer communities, continue to interview the representatives that we can get in touch with. We'll be performing some additional site visits to capture visual representations and really get in depth with our data analysis. Ultimately, we hope to identify best practices in these categories and identify which ones should be implemented based on recommendations of the EDSAT and the Economic Development Action Plan, and then look at other best practices that they're doing that we could consider here in Reading. And then lastly, how do we maintain all of this information that we're gathering and regularly update it to ensure that we're up to date with our best practices? So just to touch upon new growth here, what you're seeing here is total growth from 2003 to 2016. The purple line is the total, red is residential, and green is CIP. You can see an early increase here, which is likely attributed to the landfill development. And then we see an increase here, which is 2012-2013, with a huge residential spike that's, you know, showing here on the slide. It dominates likely due to Archstone, Johnson Woods, Redding Woods, and 30 Haven. Yep. This little bump here, although there's not necessarily one particular commercial project, we did have several along South Main Street that this is likely attributed to, the E-Cars, Calorezzo's, 95 Main Street, which is the Elise Jewelers location, Sam's Bistro.
Is it possible to instrument that chart with those timelines, those milestones? It'd be interesting to actually, you've described it in words, but put a bullet there and say that peak is the onset of Reading mm-hmm. Woods. And that, because what you've done, we've increased annual new growth almost 4.5 times over 13 years. That blue line is that's a dramatic increase. Mm-hmm. Now that's going to fall off if we don't continue to get new growth. This is, you don't get to count it 2 years in a row, right?
Right.
So we got to figure out how to keep that line high, and being able to populate this with names and relate that to folks. Hey, that's when Jordan's went in, or that's when Home Depot went in.
Mm-hmm.
I think if you start talking about a Walker's Brook 2 kind of an event, people start to get, oh, I get it. You might be able to double this again, potentially.
Yeah, we can most definitely do that.
Another interesting statistic, and I've been bringing this up to various board members, is don't ignore the what residential can provide to the tax base. When you add the Jordans and the Home Depot properties, I think there's something in the vicinity of 45 to 50 million assessed value. You look at the total build out of Reading Woods, over 125 million, over 300 condominiums and one large, I think, apartment.
It's the expense side.
So what's, look at the expense
side.
How many
kids are in Reading Woods? Over three.
It's not only about kids, though, Dan. I mean, there's
primarily kids.
There's public safety. I mean, check with the chiefs, both of them.
Yeah.
They're down there. I mean, so yes, I don't disagree that there's
net benefit huge.
You got to look at the growth and the cost of growth and the recurring cost of growth, right? The public safety, the maintenance, the mm-hmm. kids, obviously. This stuff doesn't come free.
I would submit it's not a huge amount in the property I mentioned. So I think it flies against conventional wisdom sometimes. That's all I'm saying.
Well, but, you know, to John's point, there's no way you can maintain that.
What do you mean?
That growth.
Because
you don't continue
to
count
it. No.
It will, I mean, that's going to drop off.
No, the good news is it's in the tax rolls. The next year
correct.
It gets in the
right.
base.
Right.
It's paid by that group in the first year, the new growth.
But we need to get another, 13-year span where we're kind of amping it up from this point forward, right? If we're going to move the commercial and industrial.
What are our projections saying, Bob, for
what?
New growth.
500 for 3 years, 750 after a fellow I'll introduce soon gets working.
Yeah.
That new growth
hurry
also.
Up.
No pressure, Andrew, no pressure.
That new growth also includes, the people who are adding decks to that, they're expanding their properties, they're, and that's an economic, when times are good,
that's not the
people
red line.
Will do that.
Up there.
Oh, it's the purple line.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, the red line is not decks.
And there still is growth to be
had. It is part of it.
Johnson Woods and Pulte Homes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So
it's the big stuff.
They do it, as it's assessed each year, how much is done, this is what it's worth, there's still more to come.
So that's a smear over a much longer term.
It's not just, it all comes in 1 year. Well, 30 Haven may have, since it was built in Maine and brought here. But most things develop over 2-3 years anyways.
And getting them ramped up is 2-3 years.
So in comparison with our peer communities, this is a graph showing our CIP growth relating to our peers. We are the blue, our peers are the red, we are lagging in CIP growth. I think, that was sort of shown in the last slide, but in comparison to our peers, we are as well. We do have a big increase in residential growth, but we're actually still behind our peers in that sector as well. Thinking back to the EDSAT, we do score average in some very important location criteria, but we do also fall behind in others. So really, we're going to be delving into this information again and really looking at how we compare to our peer communities and, what about these tie back to be economic indicators for Reading?
What did it mean, rents X?
Rents are too high.
Yeah.
Too high.
Okay.
Yeah.
Are those commercial rents or are those?
Yes.
Yes.
But you remember the rents are too, never mind.
Yes.
Actually, I remember when they did that thing is that they said that our rents are so low that folks are less likely to come in here and do some type of commercial
building. I don't
remember
that, honestly.
Yeah,
no,
I do.
It was
Maybe we don't have enough Class C office space.
We have a wide variety. We have good availability of office space, but it's just too high. That's what, yeah.
What we have is very expensive.
Yes.
It's usually Class A.
Can we get a peek at that as well? Is that a statistic that's easy to report peer to peer? Or is that difficult?
I'm not sure.
The rents?
Yeah, just curious. You've marked it here. I'm just curious. Is there any more color?
The rents is a difficult thing to actually to nail down. I worked on this a little bit, but so if you want to look at sales for residential, for example, or even commercial, everything is very easily attainable. It's a public record. It's easy to get at. Rents from a commercial standpoint is just the opposite. It's not something that you can easily look towards. You can get some.
Yeah,
you maybe get about a third of what the actual market is. So
I'm more interested.
Really,
are we twice? Are we a third? Is it a big or small difference?
Well, let's put an example for a peer community like Melrose. We're pretty comparable. You know, where downtown spaces are going from anywhere from, you know, $18 to $24 a square foot. However, then when you get into it even deeper, it gets even more skewed. So, if you only have 200 square feet of space you need, I can't give that to you, $18 a square foot. It's going to be a whole lot more. It's going to be more like 36, because the end number actually needs to justify it. But for 1,000 square feet, yeah, well, now we can talk about that price point. So it fluctuates depending on the size that you're going to be renting as well from a space standpoint. So there's where the problem really lies. And that's why I think the data out there is just kind of is tough to come by.
Is that just so it's a supply problem? If there was more supply, the rates had come down because demand.
That's supply of bigger properties.
Sorry,
that's definitely part of it. Yeah,
you've got insufficient availability. Supply is outstripping.
Right.
Demand.
As far as people wanting to, you mean the supply of people wanting to take your space? Is that what you're saying?
If you have excess capacity, prices drop. If you have insufficient capacity and people are competing for it, prices get bid up.
Right. Right.
So if you have more supply. What do you do about it is the question. We don't control the property, but maybe you can facilitate.
That
ought to be part of our calculation. How do we add more to the more supply?
That'd be an interesting question for the folks in the business community, you know, because I feel like there'd be another piece to that equation. It's not just simply supply, you know, location factors, condition of the rental space. I bet there'd be a lot of other factors that go into it. Just other than
the supply.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sorry, Jesse.
No, please, I'm taking notes. It's good.
I just
discussion.
Might add, hold that thought for the Board of Assessors. That's part of their expertise.
Okay, good.
Rental is an offset. They a lot of the commercial valuations are done on cash flow, and rental in some cases is an offset to a business. So it's up to the business whether to disclose the rent or not to the assessors. When it's to their advantage, they will. So
and when
the
it's not, they don't.
Probably the most information on rents. It's not public, just to be clear. And it's not public for a reason, but they do have pretty good knowledge and can speak, you know, on
okay.
a broad
that's
level
the, that's
pretty
the
well.
Key way to value a commercial property
yeah.
is its
absolutely.
NOI. And if you're not getting good information on NOI, then you're not going to get good valuations.
And the reason they get it is because it is guaranteed not to be public information.
Right.
So.
And that's got to be that's a
but they can speak at the aggregate quite well on this topic.
So when we visually look at new growth on a map, we started to see some trends in terms of the location, and so we overlaid the highway system, and we start to see a correlation between highway access and higher growth. What's interesting about this is Reading is smack dab in the middle, and we have four access points to the highway.
Right.
And we're not taking advantage.
It's an anomaly.
Yeah.
We're on the highway and we're not growing.
Yeah.
We got two highways.
Yeah.
And we're
we
not
have
taking
four access points.
That's a real aha moment, folks. We've got the best real estate in town. You can get to any place within 15 minutes.
And all we do with it is repair the roads so that people can drive
by
through.
Car or by train.
Honestly, that's what's going on. That is exactly what's happening. We're
so
not taking advantage of that very thing. Andrew, no pressure.
Residential growth is less consistent with the highways, but we still wanted to visualize it for you on a map. you know, Lexington, Winchester, Belmont, Concord, Westford all have seen high residential growth, and even Reading on this map. So what we're going to start really looking into, and this is just a little peek into some analysis that we've done, but we're really going to try and find out what correlation and relationships exist between the varying data sets as they, or you know, what we can call economic indicators as they relate to growth. So this is one example, and we wanted to see whether there was a correlation between residential growth and vacant residential land. There is somewhat of a trend, and Reading is slightly above the trend line there.
So what is that telling us?
So that's showing a slight trend between the amount of vacant residential land
that's built that we could just add more housing to.
Right, that's the thought. You know, this is all based on assessor land use information that we have. So, you know, some of this, you know, is all on how we classify vacant land. But, you know, using it at face value, we do see a little bit of a trend there.
If you don't have it to sell, you can't count it as growth. So if you cut communities with less vacant land.
Well, you could have teardowns. Teardowns count as not.
True, but that's kind of a background rate. That's going to happen anyway.
So we're low on the availability of land, but it looks like we're doing the best with what we have.
Yeah, we're doing a good
job. For residential,
there.
Yeah.
Right. Residential.
Exactly.
Pretty large.
So talking about CIP growth, going back to CIP, again, this is showing that correlation with highway access and CIP growth. Bedford, Burlington, and Winchester doing the best, along with Westboro and Dedham.
Boy, North Reading is in the same boat. That's really amazing. You would think with all their vacant land.
They have no place to wash the toilets.
No water.
They have no sewers.
We really need to join the two communities.
That's the problem.
I'll tell
you, North Reading is going to become a huge competitor of ours once we've given them the water.
What have we done?
They still don't have
got
a place to put it.
But we've got the switch to control the water.
We're only going to give them water. We're not going to take anything back.
So similar exercise, we compared CIP new growth to vacant CI land, and there's less of a correlation, but what's important to know about this particular chart is that we have L1 and L2. L1 is representing Lexington, L2 is representing Linfield, and they have done better with the same amount or lack of vacant land than we have. So Linfield is interesting because, you know, we can probably attribute that back to their Market Street development.
Right.
Lexington, we're not quite sure. We are meeting with them in a couple weeks. Maybe
there's
we'll have some
more. There's a lot of
office
parks off of parts of the back of Route 2 and Concord Street that you don't see.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't even know you're in Lexington.
Mm-hmm.
That border on the Waltham.
Yep.
Huge commercial office
yep.
complexes that are in Lexington.
Okay.
Cubist is there, a bunch of other big
yeah.
corporations. And that, you know, it's out of the eye.
Yeah.
But it counts.
Yeah, so we are going to meet with them in a couple weeks. So it'll be interesting to see, to, you know, kind of get their perspective on this.
Jesse, one question here. So that land wasn't vacant previously. It was a golf course and it had a Sheraton on it. So is it considered vacant land for the purposes of this?
That probably would not have been considered vacant land, but as a whole, I mean, that all else aside, the amount of vacant land that they had, they're still doing better with what they had.
They had a small amount of vacant land because that wasn't classified as vacant land.
Yeah.
That was open space, but it was not vacant land.
Yeah, but it's a one and done. It's a 1 year one and done. It's
yeah.
it's not a trend, right?
It's a big one.
Yeah, and,
yeah.
and the big one is, I mean, besides the commercial activity, the impact on the taxes from a golf course to, you know, what they put there is
oh, it's
just
huge.
Yeah.
Fantastic idea.
You have a ton of rental housing there too, isn't it?
Yeah.
Golf course, just saying.
Okay, so some more information here. This is CIP new growth to CIP land. So this isn't vacant land. This is what they currently have as CI land use. So thinking along the lines of possibly redevelopment. Does redevelopment drive growth more than the vacant land does? These are the things we're going to be looking at in more detail, but this is what we're seeing right now.
So more land gets you more CIP growth. So that argues against redevelopment.
Well, what it says is
the existing CIP land, the
yeah.
more existing land use of commercial and industrial, there seems to be more growth.
I'm sorry. I saw the word vacant.
No, no longer vacant, this is.
Yeah, if you took away the vacant land.
Right.
You'd see a pretty strong correlation between commercial growth and the amount of commercial businesses. You know, it's almost as if, well, they went there, so I better also.
That's what's happening in Burlington.
It's kind of a.
Well, it's the thing that we heard from the very beginning of these discussions, when it was a simple thing like a restaurant. You'd think that competition is a problem, quite the opposite. You know, if you put six of them together, all boats rise together. And
it's the Market Street phenomenon.
So does this dictate a strategy of, let's find a really good project, and then that becomes what we do, and then that, you know, it ripples? Is that kind of what
this? It'll foster redevelopment because we don't have vacant land. So you got to get an anchor in.
You got to do your project.
You do a special anchor. Now all of a sudden we become attractive.
Right. I mean, in the interviews and site visits I've had, that's certainly the case. You see very like industries hanging out with other similar industries, and it just builds on itself. So, and I think that was mentioned either in the EDSAT or the economic development plan, was that you kind of have to find a niche. You have to have some sort of industry attractor that's going to attract.
If only we had the cheapest electricity in the state.
Yeah.
What a thought that is.
And two major highways that intersect us.
But the hook, from what I'm hearing, and tell me if I'm wrong, isn't so much the big box stores, but the mid box stores
are really the hook for other ones to want to jump on board. In other words, you know, we have a Home Depot down there, but if you had smaller, more boutique style box stores, that you're actually getting better attraction for people wanting to build and come in around that.
Mm-hmm.
Is that kind of holding true?
We haven't really got into that level of detail yet, but I think we're going to see that.
It's going to be interesting as you continue with this.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to develop, you know, say too much about all the talks that I've had so far. I really want to, you know, try to limit our discussion.
Yeah, and we could do this all night long, too.
But yeah, I mean, it's so interesting. I mean, meeting with, you know, Bedford and Wilmington and Tewksbury, and just each community has just blown my mind in a different way. It's just, it's pretty cool on, you know, what they're doing and how it works. And so I think we're really going to learn a lot just from the data collection and sort of the qualitative information we're gathering.
Of those peer communities that we were talking about, off the top of my head, it's only Wilmington, Melrose, Reading, and there might have been a couple more on the South Shore that I might have missed, that have public transportation into Boston. Lexington does, Winchester actually does. So, I mean, are those communities optimizing their commuter rail development?
Some of the responses back on the surveys did say that transportation is a challenge in some respect. And those communities that don't have rail, what I'm finding is they're really working regionally to implement other forms of transportation options. I don't know how many of you are familiar with like the 128 Business Council, and they provide transportation. The Middlesex 3 Coalition, they work with other communities to hire transportation that comes from Alewife up to their communities to bring that talent out to the suburbs. So transportation is a challenge. We have it, so, which is good.
It's going to be exciting to hear your next iteration of this, because you're like, you know.
Can you go back to that last slide before we vectored off into public?
Can't go too far back.
That's right, right there.
Getting pretty far behind.
No other community in our area of total commercial industrial land has got growth substantially better than us. We've got to get to the right on that chart if we've got a prayer of getting our growth up north. We've got to do another sizable event that introduces more of that land and opens it up. This is a big lift we're going to end up having to do. There's no one else in our silo that's doing better than we are substantially. You got to really get to the right in order to get your growth numbers up high. That's really eye-opening. I wouldn't have necessarily guessed that.
So similar exercise, CIP new growth to tax rates. What we're observing is higher growth with higher tax rate, which is interesting.
So are you suggesting there's a cause and effect there? Or
not necessarily cause, there's a correlation, and we're hoping to look into it further.
So are you suggesting that as growth goes up, the tolerance for tax rates goes up? Or are you saying, raise the taxes and we'll get growth?
What I'm saying is there's just a correlation, that we see a correlation. So.
You're talking the CIP rate, not the total CIP tax.
Correct.
Level.
Right.
And that's a cause. That's a correlation, not a causation.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
We don't. Yeah,
one
we
one leg and the other.
We don't know which came first.
Right.
Well,
chicken and
well,
egg.
It's one piece of a statistic.
Right.
Yeah. All right. So I'm actually going to turn it over to Bob. He's going to talk about a case study with Wakefield.
Thanks. This is the CIP growth, just indexed to a starting year of 2000. And note we share the same assessor, at least now. Wakefield's slightly ahead of us in terms of, this is absolute dollar values indexed.
And you're indexed
you can
to
see
what,
the different
Bob?
Paths. Just arbitrarily starting in the year 2003, because that's where the Massachusetts DOR data is very available, becomes available in 2003.
What was the 2005 to 2008 event that push that red line up like that, do you know?
In Wakefield, no, I don't. But I think we might
yeah,
get it.
We have lots of different projects going on, too.
And here's a look at Reading.
Yep.
And the green line, again, is the total. And the blue line is commercial. And the green line is personal property. The blue line is commercial. The red line is industrial. So that's not a huge surprise. We've had a couple of industrial pieces of property, such as the old Oregon factory on Pierce Street and whatever, discontinued. And our commercial value has actually been, it's almost double in this 13
What's
years.
What's the y-axis?
Which goes up and down and which
yes.
goes across.
Up and down.
Just a ratio, so it's just starting at a 1.0 factor.
Just normalized
based on dollars,
2000.
Just normalized.
Okay, yeah. It's
so,
not, yeah,
so
certainly
personal
property is not in total value
no,
more than.
It's, but it's
yeah.
grown at a faster
right.
clip
and,
over
and,
that period
and
of time.
And Wakefield is?
They're the next chart. So
oh,
this
oh
is only
okay.
Reading.
This is just
oh.
Reading in
oh,
the Reading and Wakefield Reading. Study.
So
yeah.
I'm sorry, Bob, if the Oregon factory comes off, how does that change?
Well, that turned into housing, so.
So that comes off.
Industrial.
Okay, it comes out of the base then. It's not C anymore.
Right.
Right.
So it should bring the, okay.
And this is Wakefield. Remember, they were ahead of us over that period of time. The red and blue lines are almost indistinguishably the same.
Yeah.
So their assessed value in commercial and industrial is almost identical to what it was 13 years ago. They've got all their new growth in this sector from personal property.
What's the nature of the personal property?
That's the little smart guy in the middle when they hired a certain assessor. And so did we. 2 years after he started, I don't know if I should preview his presentation.
So he has a team of people that are looking at this.
He outsourced a data collection agency in Wakefield. Their tax rate is $27 per thousand for commercial.
Severe.
And they went around and collected data from office parks, which we don't really have, so they could do it economically and just gather what equipment do you have, what computers, what technology, and they have some high-tech businesses in town.
Mm.
So they have completely grown their CIP base by one thing, whereas we're struggling
yeah.
to keep up by doing many things.
So Wakefield has a split tax. So Wakefield's tax rate, commercial tax rate, compared to Reading's is almost 2-1.
Yeah.
Yep.
So
today.
Is there a correlation, the fact that Wakefield's growth in industrial and commercial has basically remained unchanged for 13 years, is that because they have that high tax rate and they're driving the values down?
I don't know.
Because if you flip it to Reading,
yeah.
ours has gone up
I don't
a little bit, but our rate.
I don't know the history of their tax rate to be able to answer
can
that question.
Can you go
question?
Back one slide for a second, please?
Yeah, if I can figure it out.
Oh, here. You made it.
Previous. So there's Reading.
Okay.
I don't know the answer to your
question. So the delta, the overall delta, all in.
Same. They're a little ahead.
I mean, it's 0.2%. It's 6.8 versus 7.0.
We just get it from three different places.
We just get
it, or lose
yes.
it.
And if you look at our, all you have to do also is look at our personal property, and it has spiked apparently at the same time.
But not nearly as much as theirs.
Okay, but you know.
But at the end of the day, the business gets that as a blended number, so they're almost ignorant of
when
what
you're all in,
contributors
it's, when you're
are.
All in, there's no difference between the two towns' growth.
They're not going to see it in the blend.
But the amount of dollars in personal property, even in Wakefield, is much less than commercial.
A lot less.
It's a tiny number, so it's easier to grow it. This is, again, just indexed.
That's correct. And
oh, it's off the smart base.
It's big enough so that they've kept up with Reading by only doing that one thing, if you will.
But what that is, and, you know, and we also don't see here is the cost to grow that.
Right.
Okay, because there is a cost to grow that. Mm-hmm. You got to have the little guys running around mm-hmm. with the clipboards. Okay, and that is very different than what we're doing right now.
Right.
Yet, you know, the delta is, you know, 20 basis points.
It's a
zero delta, really, in the big picture of things over that window of time. So. You know, I mean, you could argue this in a couple of different ways, but from the standpoint of sustained value to the revenue base, the personal property is a wild card.
Yes.
It's absolute wild card. When you have your blue line moving the way ours does in comparison to what's going on in Wakefield, that's real value that locks itself in.
And you may do a better job on the personal property if you have a good commercial base to grow up.
Right.
Yep. If you flip back to Wakefield, so we're at 2.64 in 2016. Where did they end up? I know this is cumulative.
Six.
So a factor of three.
Yeah. I just thought it was interesting.
It sure
towns
is.
That share
it is.
The same
it is
ancestor that are next to each other, that optically might look similar, but when you look at the details, are quite different.
I think a great. I mean, and we can maybe defer this to when Victor comes in, but I would like to see, you take a mythic piece of property. Commercial property. You put it in Reading and use how we assess it there, and then you put it in Wakefield, and to see if there's a correlation between how that property is assessed versus its tax rate, i.e., is there more pressure to drive the valuation down because you have a higher tax rate than it would. I mean, that's how you have to see it. It's not so much the tax rate or the valuation, it's what is an individual owner paying for his or her taxes. That's really what people care about.
Well, because we haven't seen anything in the way of real dollars,
right,
and real revenues. As a result of that, so you know, I think we do have to defer that for Victor, and we can spin him in circles for a while. In the meantime, I think we need to move through with this.
Oh yeah, okay, yeah, this is it. Questions for you. What else?
So one last question. So you went and you sent out surveys to 26 towns or 50 and got a bunch back. How many other people are doing what you just did to actually assess how they're doing? Is it safe to say we're the only one?
Yes.
So again, we're at the head of the curve on trying to figure stuff out, and this was a great presentation. Really,
this is one of the best economic presentations I've seen.
This is some really interesting.
It creates so much discussion points.
I feel like it's just the tip of the iceberg too, from what you're about to really go delve into.
We don't really know what we don't know yet.
Okay, we're going to keep the hook in you.
So what else? Hopefully,
he figured that out. Anything else? Obviously, just email.
I mean, if something comes up, certainly
email
Bob.
Yeah,
we're
email
over
me,
now.
You know.
Is there a period of time where you think you might be able to come back? Like, if they'll have a finished product or more?
We've been talking about it, and I was hoping for February-ish. So we'll have to see how the data collection continues to go and how deep we're really the rabbit hole goes. You know, but I certainly want to come back to you guys and before we give a final deliverable to see if there's any additional thoughts, and then
this
wrap
is
it up
really
after
good,
that.
Jesse.
So
this is really good.
It's awesome.
Yeah.
Very thought provoking. I'm really looking forward to your next round.
Great.
Thank you. Good to have you back.
Thanks.
Yeah, only for a short time.
Okay.
If I might
showtime for the
briefly introduce our new economic development director. Andrew Corona, who's hiding in the back. Oh, now he's standing. Andrew comes to us. He'll start working in a couple weeks. He comes to us most recently from the city of Kent, Washington. He spent his whole career in economic development. Prior to that, he was working for a private nonprofit in New Mexico for over 10 years, dealing with big issues and statewide issues. And prior to that, he worked in Glendale, Arizona. So of all the interviews we had, we had some very qualified candidates. One of the attractions was Andrew, that he had no idea what Massachusetts is all about, and that's a good thing. We hope not to scare him off too much when he finds out. But
this might not have been a great idea to bring him down here tonight before we actually had him.
I know. I think the outside view will be really interesting. coupled with some of the inside view, if you will, as to what happens with this. You know, Andrew does not have any of the preconceived notions. He doesn't know that there is a box to stay inside of. Off we go. So I just wanted to introduce
Andrew. Welcome aboard.
Yeah, welcome aboard is right. No pressure.
Exactly.
I hope you can walk on water.
Go forth and multiply.
I told you Bill would be looking for you.
I can show you a stepping stone.
Okay. So yours should be here, I think. Are they next or yours?
Okay.
Oh, okay.
Jean, are you going to...
We're going to go into the Reading Village Depot, and then I'm going to say a few words.
John, you have a question from the audience. Which one of these do you want to first?
Yes.
Yes.
I call the Zoning Board of Appeals to order 5F.
Please do.
Thank you.
Okay. Zoning Board of Appeals is in session.
And if you folks wouldn't mind introducing yourselves.
Yes, of course.
It's so good when you do that. You remind me that I should have said, you know, that it's... 15th of November, and the Board of Selectmen are in session. We just
flew in.
So anyway, please.
Thank you. Good evening, Mr. Chair, members of the Selectmen, the Zoning Board, members of the public, town officials. Matthew Zucca from MKM Reading, and here with Ken Chase and Matt Roman from MKM Reading. I actually have hard copies too of what's on there. I don't know if the board would like copies or just looking at the screen is fine.
We're kind of expecting that we would get them like before today. Would have been a nice touch.
Yeah.
Just saying, you know. We had no idea why you were coming here.
That's news to me, so I wasn't...
Well, it's news to us. I mean, we knew you were coming.
Yeah.
Honestly, just, you know, and I... Just to not run too far off the rails here and turn you loose to please tell us. It's our general expectation when somebody's going to come to... You know, talk about their project, that we have a little something in advance so that we can ask an educated question and be able to look at it. And we actually had absolutely no idea other than the fact you guys wanted to stop in and say hello. So we're glad you're here.
That's good. Well, hello. Again, that's news to me. So,
with that as a backdrop, maybe you could tee it up.
We'll tee it up for you. So we've actually, as you know, may have known, we've gone through a long, lengthy process with Reading Village. I'm not going to get too much in the details, but there's a draft decision out. There's about 2 points kind of that we're down to talking about. One of them is off-street loading and like a service area for unloading and loading. The code requires 4 spaces per 20 units. We've looked at and we've asked for a waiver from that for it in the zoning bylaw. We've looked at putting it on site. We've moved our building around, we put it in a spot, and what that entailed, I can show you here, on the westerly side along Prescott Street, you can see the existing building, and there's a number of on-street parking spaces there, and then right where that building ends, and then all the way wrapping the corner, almost all the way down to the building on Lincoln Street, is not curved right now. Obviously the auto body's there and you have entrances and exits, so that's there's no on-street parking there, and then there's a few more spaces as you get in front of the building on Lincoln Street. So when we've been looking at our plan, we looked at keeping that and not putting curbing on the corner, but instead of putting a loading zone there on our property. We went through peer review on that, and it really isn't the ideal location for that. It takes away the ability to curb that and do other things there, and their peer review consultant for the town as well, as we concluded that may not be the best location.
If you actually point at the map, it might
be. So from here all the way down to here basically is not curbed. There's one little spot right on the corner, like literally on the corner right here, that is curbed. And we had looked at pulling a loading zone right in front of the building where you kind of want it to be. There's some times of the year there'll be some moving in. Especially initially, but then after that, it's more like a delivery service or elderly transportation for the elderly, or you know, some type of service that was more transient or loaded. So we looked at some other alternatives, and then we moved to the next.
Before you leave that,
was that the next card?
I had a question on the Prescott Street spaces. I have a picture of an overlay that was in our material that shows parking spaces consuming one of the lanes of Prescott.
Is that an accurate depiction of
what? Yeah, that's an overview that the architects do. The engineers is more so to scale. So the right-of-way on Prescott Street, I believe, is 40, just the right-of-way, not the pavement, but the right-of-way is 45 feet, and on Lincoln Street is 50 feet.
Yeah.
The pavement on Prescott Street, the width is about 30 feet,
right.
And it's about 40, and it varies on Prescott Street. So when you do a space that's 18, we're actually reconfigured a little, so there'll be 30, there's 32 width, sorry, the space is 8. So if you take the 32 minus the 8 for the space, would leave you an aisle of 24 there, which is basically what's there now. We had proposed not doing curbing here and doing like a Cape Cod berm so people could pull up onto it. But the town engineer wanted to have the curbing there. So we're not changing the width of the pavement. It gets, when they overlay that, it's not as accurate as a civil drawing. The civil drawings are scaled out. That's more for illustrative purposes. But I understand the comment that was made and the comment that you're making. So we want to make sure that the pavement width outside what's on, this is all out of our property. This is on street, the town. There currently is these spaces here. You want to make sure that it's still passable, whatever is done in the future, that it still is the same that there is now or improved, which we're trying to do. So I will just quickly, I'm sure I'll be able to. So this is our proposed building. We could get in any questions on that, Ava, but we have the corner piece now, so it's a long building that encompasses the piece we had before and the corner piece. So we have an entrance to the building here on Prescott and here on Lincoln, and we have on-street parking shown here, similar as before, same type of thing. We'll have curbing, on-street space, and then enough that meets some so you could pass. And then here, right here and here on Lincoln, we would propose two service zones. So there's a bigger service zone here, and service zone is what it's called in the Reading parking and traffic regulations, and then a smaller one here. So this one's 30 feet, this one's 16 feet, so you'd have a total length of 46 feet here, and then you would still be able to provide the same amount of on-street spaces that were there before, because all this area that was before not curbed now has a curb. So ultimately, under the parking regulations, the selectmen have the authority to designate service areas for transient parking and loading and unloading. We had a loading spot here on our plan, on our property. It just, the way to get into it is, you know, you back into it. In reality, the best thing to do, and our door is here, is, you know, people, the most it would be used would be having it in front. So that a few times a year people moved, it could be a little, most of these units are one bedrooms, they could have a little moving van here, and then for delivery services, or you're picking someone up or dropping someone off. So again, it's under the purview of the selectmen to designate it. We're not asking it to be specific for us. You know, there's commercial property here. They may be, you know, it's really for the service for anyone in this side of the train tracks or anywhere else, but downtown. And that's kind of the gist of what we're here for tonight. We've also had separately, so I don't know, just discussions with town officials and departments on how to better utilize some of the downtown Reading parking that basically is very busy, you know, at certain hours. They say 6:30, 7 to, you know, 3 to 4 to 5, 6 at night. And then other than that, it's pretty empty. So right across the street, there's 57 spaces the town owns at the commuter rail. So we'd like to, and we've read reports from the past that the parking in downtown Reading is underutilized. So I don't know, you know, in the future if there's a way, a method we could come in and talk about, like a pilot program to better utilize maybe some of this parking over here, because we've had comments on, you know, excess parking and where, you know, visitors or park, and I think just in general, I think the discussions have been started about utilizing the parking better. So,
but not for exclusive use.
Not for exclusive use. We'd be happy to continue if we could, you know, have those conversations or be part of them. We'd be happy to assist or take part in those. So ultimately, what we're here to discuss specifically is the request, at least start the process of requesting that this area be designated as service zones under the parking and traffic regulations. And what I just want to point out is that the same number of on-street parking that is in there now would be provided for in the future, so it wouldn't be taking away from any on-street parking that is there now.
I don't know if anyone else has a problem. I can't see that laser pointer to save my...
It's a little tight, yeah.
Are we talking about the properties on High Street? Is that the... Just use your finger. That always works.
Right here?
There you go, mouse. Yeah, there you go.
I use the mouse is in there.
So that's a 30-foot long loading zone?
Yes.
And that's a 16-foot long loading zone.
And you're required to have one per 20 units?
You're required to have one loading zone for one per 20 units. It's not a common requirement in the code, but it is in the zoning code.
Okay, and a loading zone is defined as how many feet? Now, those counted as one or two by virtue of their size?
That's a good question. I'm not sure what the exact requirements. 30 is the general, when they do it on the plan, is 30 feet for a loading zone.
And Gene, this has 8 spots marked for parking. And the current plan, the earlier slide, what was the effective count in the earlier?
Well,
they were both 9. So you have you have 6 to here, 7, 8, 9 here.
Total. Oh, I see. Because of the curb.
Because this is all not curved right now.
It's not curved, and you can't
park
there.
Except for the small little piece on the corner here.
And none of those are obviously striped out. We're just showing them.
Correct.
Correct.
So that.
And the setback from the curb required for turning radius is what, 20 feet? That's all observed here?
Yeah, I mean, we've taken the code, the engineers. We had engineers talking about parking, keeping the parking away from entrances and on the curb. So I'm not sure specifically.
Okay.
This one here.
So the operative question is, you need 4 and you got 2, right? You need 4 loading zones and you got 2 here.
Right, but the question, we've asked for a waiver from that and under the comp permit application.
Right.
So all we're, but the specifics of what here tonight is just our belief that that's the best space for loading, even if we had 4 on our property, the best space for having them to be used is in front of the front door where people are coming and going, and it makes the most sense to have a little place to pull over, pick someone up, drop off groceries, have an elderly van, and for the few times a year, coordinating, moving during certain hours. We believe that's the best space, even if we had 4 on our property, that they wouldn't get utilized as much as having them in front of the building.
I think if those are parking spots, if those are assigned, what happens, we've all seen the UPS truck just double park and run in to deliver a package. So by having this designated, it's really your...
Can you point out the entrances, both out on the street and on the parking, on the inside parking?
This is the drive.
I mean, for the door entrances.
This is your entrance here.
Okay.
It doesn't show much there, but this basically area here, and here is your leasing office and your common area.
Okay.
And your elevators are right here.
I see.
These are more emergency. There's the egress stairs here, and these are more the exits from the egress stairs. But your elevators are here, and that would be your point of entry to the common space and the lobby.
So that proposed loading area is where the current driveway is for the garage. It's there now. That's why it does not take away from the parking.
Yeah,
it's all curb cut. At the moment.
It's all just kind of a mess right there now.
Right.
How many parking spots are there internal to the proposal now?
There's plus 72 or 73, depending on how the columns end up falling in the building.
Okay, call it 72, 73. How many units are in the present design?
72.
So you're right at 1.
We're at 1.
Or under.
Yeah. We're at 1.
If you get 72.
Yeah.
You be more specific about the agreements you're seeking for off-site parking on other properties?
Not
on currently occupied town parking on the depot or on the street, but on adjacent private properties or those owned by the MBTA.
We've had discussions with the MBTA.
Yeah.
And
they had told us that they weren't interested in making any kind of arrangements with us for
about private landowners adjacent to the property. any of them?
There's, you know, if you're taking, there's only one adjacent property that has any parking, but if you're making a deal with them, you're taking away from their parking. And when we looked at it, they wouldn't be, you know, they had barely, you know, they had units there, so. And then once we start looking across the tracks, as we have a map that the town actually prepared some time ago that shows town-owned and private parking all throughout there. At some point, we're further away that people are gonna park, you know, and wanna walk closer to where they are. So now looking, you know, I think it made more sense to look at the spaces at night. The majority of a visitor or somebody here is coming in the evening hours. And that's not saying everybody is, but the majority is gonna come in the evening. And when they come in the evening, all those spaces across the street are basically empty. Even during the day, they're almost all full, but I've been there plenty of times during the day. There's still always, you know, one or two. It's today's work schedule. Some people come back early and leave really early, come back early. And I've always been able to find one or two, but after 3 o'clock, they really start to open up and everything. So I know there's other programs in town for downtown employees to park. There's lots downtown that have overnight parking. So we did have a meeting with DPW and the police and the town about, you know, just some ideas or concerns or logistics of how these things work. There's no set way to do it. Concerns like, you know, plowing and stuff like that. But 350 days of the year, 40 days of the year when we don't have snow, parking across there is an ideal. And most of the time you actually can park there. I think it's November through April from 1 in the morning to 6 in the morning is when you can't park in those spots, if I think I'm correct here. So it's just a discussion of, is there a better way to do it?
There's no overnight parking in any of the public. Right.
That's correct. Yes, Dan.
Yeah, we are not just concerned about provision of guest parking. We are concerned about the fact that many of these units will have multiple vehicles, sometimes two vehicles, and you only have provision for one vehicle per unit right now. That's a major issue, I think, with myself and I think my fellow board members. And I don't hear any plans from you about provision for off-site parking on other areas. What are we saying here?
But we're comfortable with the 1.0 ratio. We provided data on.
We're not.
Oh, ratio. I think under the domain, you know, the train station there, we're going through a comp permit where that has been the last, if not the last issue, but the last big issue we're exploring with the board. So that's where we're at with, you know, the comp permit process.
Gene, is there any way that we can assist the developers with introductions to the MBTA? It sounds like
we did that.
They did that yeah. on their own, but I mean, if no. they knew that it was no, important,
we
did it.
Wait,
I don't think they did it on their own.
Yeah.
We also talked about, I forget the term, but this concept of sharing some of the, maybe that's what Dan was getting at, but sharing some of the private areas. And I guess only one property falls under that. It's close enough to.
There's a time phased of day thing you can do with
yeah, we actually encourage shared parking.
Yeah, I know that.
there's a provision in the zoning bylaw for shared parking. It doesn't have to be right next door. Mm-hmm. It could be any number of creative approaches to shared parking. So we talk about it a lot in planning and certainly at the CPDC. The trick with the parking on this one, obviously, is that we don't know how many cars are going to come here. We know that in the smart growth district, right across the tracks, where we ended up was at 1.25 per unit.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So we started at 1.5.
We started.
Right. And we fought like cats and dogs to rationalize getting to 1.25.
Yeah.
So we think 1.25 is a number that generally has some comfort level.
Yeah, I'd be happy with that.
And that's what the zoning board has been discussing, 1.25.
So it's another 18 spots.
Correct. Basically.
But you need a solution for that before you ink the agreement.
Yeah.
Right?
Correct.
I don't see one.
So you have 18 spots plus potentially two more loading zones to address.
Yeah.
The corner of the property, that rightmost, almost vertical hatch mark, is that in a street? I'm sorry.
Right here?
The right side of the document, that vertical line, is that a street?
No, that's, I
that's
think
a note.
That's a property line?
Which one, right here?
Exactly, yeah.
That's a property line.
Okay, thank you.
Yep. And just a quick point, and a lot of these specifics are, we're going through the comp permit, and the ZBA comp permit is kind of the details where we're going through the waiver request on parking ratio. But our project that is presently proposed is almost all one-bedroom units.
60, right.
Not, which is a, you know, a huge amount of one-bedrooms. It has a fiscal benefit. But if you actually look at then the parking breakdown per bedroom between, say, us and 30 Haven, it's almost identical. So even if, once you start playing with those ratios, so I think the thought process is you get one space per unit, and if you don't use it, there's a reduction, and someone else could rent that space on a month-to-month basis if they needed more than one. Also, the market dictates. If somebody says, I have to have three cars, and we say you could only have one car, there's plenty of other places that they could, I mean, this isn't the only rental in town. There's plenty of places near the highway. So from a marketing standpoint, being on the train, we were comfortable with the majority of one bedrooms. We also believe the train, but and just the one bedrooms does lead into the argument that a 1.0 ratio may be more important. And that's not to say people, well, everyone won't have a car, but there may be some people who don't have a car.
So you're gonna, in your rental agreement, you're gonna limit one car per unit?
We were gonna, that was gonna be in the operating and management, that it's one car per unit, and if you don't use the car, you, there would be, instead of paying for it, you maybe you get a something off of your rent a month.
Oh, so a market
and then
solution.
Your, that unit can be marketed, this can be rented to another unit only on a month, you know, on a month-to-month basis under the guise.
Would you consider marking some of these units as without parking to take your idea one step further and formalize it? Would you consider taking some of these units and there's no parking? You are a commuter, you have a bicycle, you use Uber, and that therefore brings you down to the, gets you the effective ratio. It's exactly what you're talking about, except you're formalizing it in the,
which is, which at its face, that it, but if so, if you do that, you may end up having spaces that aren't used either. So I think if you say,
we're saying you need 18 more. You're saying that some people won't need the spaces and might be willing to rent them. I'm simply saying, if you believe that, let's formalize it. Let's make some of these that have no parking.
I think the 1.25, again, there's no answer. There's no, like, you can't just open a book and say one's the right 1.25. We've done a lot of research on it. I mean, that's on different projects that have this. The town of Reading actually did a lengthy study about six years ago, a lengthy study that says for the downtown area, we recommend a parking ratio of no more than one per unit max, and it was a maximum. So, and not to say that that is the end all and be all right answer, but when we factor in 30 Haven, which we had discussions with, that also has some commercial spaces in the garage, and said that they don't even always use the spaces they do have, with the fact we're a little closer, we're all one bedrooms, and I could point to four or five projects recently that are all at the 1.0, that's the trend. So I think there's a discussion on the logistics of the marketing, you know, how do you do
that? I asked you a formal question, and the reason is you could actually start there, and if you found you had excess, you could always reverse it. It's really hard to go the other way. But if you found you had spaces that weren't being used, you could have a rational basis to say, okay, I want to make that part of a deal going forward, or a unit going forward. If I don't have enough parking spaces, I can't create them. But if I market some of these to folks that don't have cars, and you find out you have extra spaces, you can always undo that. And so my question stands. Would you be willing to turn some of these into parcels, single units, that have no included parking?
But then are you also saying the rest of them that would have it is just one space?
With no other changes, correct.
Okay.
So that frees up, taken from that 72 and says, for the sake of argument, it goes down to 64 or 62. That doesn't get you to 18, but it gets you back half of it. And it takes the sentiment that's been expressed here at face value and says, fine, let's do it. Codify it. Put it in the deed agreement for those units, and that's
rental,
how you go forward.
Rental discount.
Yeah, and they get a lower discount. I'm just taking your words and giving them back to you.
But we also, you know, say every unit wants one car. I mean, I think from a business standpoint, we're trying to say the same thing, but from a business standpoint, I just don't, I mean, I think that would.
You said earlier there were some that wouldn't want any.
I believe so.
Let's check. Try it.
That's, I think our solution is actually, that's the goal of what we're
So the idea of formalizing it is not something you'd consider?
We're very comfortable with our 1.0, and from a business marketing, that's what the...
So let me ask this question a different way. Are you interested in the idea that Mr. Arena is giving to you? Would you be willing to consider formalizing some apartments without a parking space?
I don't think it's an answer that I could just say no or yes to. I think we...
You just
certainly
said no.
It's an interesting...
You just said no.
It's an interesting proposition. There's also other factors that would come into play with something like that. You know, I thought, again, it's the first time I heard it too, so it's, you know.
Well, there's a lot of firsts tonight, so, and yeah. As the hour grows late, let me ask you, what is your goal this evening with the Board of Selectmen?
Which should begin the discussion on loading the service zones.
Okay, so we've done that.
Yeah.
And I'm going to trust that, you know, we'll get some kind of a documentation along with your thoughts on this that we could actually sit and think about a little bit, you know, more than, you know, 15 minutes while you were trying to tell us and sell us. I mean, this is common practice at this Board of Selectmen is that we like to review what we're going to talk about. And so we would just ask that, now we've created a discussion, this is good. I'm going to guess you're going to send this to us. Right?
Of course.
Okay. Because the only thing that we got was from neighbors who sent us some stuff going crazy. And I understand why. Because, you know, kind of the process here is a little choppy. Just trying to be honest with you. And I know what you're, I think I know now what you're looking for. And I think we should talk about it. I think John's brought up an interesting point. I think that's what, this is not, I mean, I think that you realize that a lot of people, both on this board and on the zoning Board of Appeals, are trying to work closely with you to make it work for everybody. I think there's been a lot of energy and effort put into that on both sides.
And I think both boards, I am surprised that the board wasn't aware of the reason we were coming in.
It's your obligation to advise us why you're coming. Okay, I can't say that in an any more clear way.
If we were to put forward a narrative describing what we're looking for along with a plan, would that be sufficient?
That would be helpful, yeah. That would be very helpful. I appreciate it. I personally would appreciate that. I don't know if any...
And a purpose for the meeting. What's the desired outcome of the meeting? What's the subject matter you hope to discuss? Give me some of the materials in advance. We all look at this stuff on Thursday night when it gets published. So we're all studying this stuff for a couple hours on the weekend so we can not come up to speed, but actually know about it. So, and we're all interested in this stuff. You guys are too. We're trying to get to yes. And we're farther apart than I would like. It certainly would help to get some of the materials sooner.
Yep. So just a quick question too. Bob, is there also a procedure, I'm assuming, that would go along with something like this where we're talking about taking a public spaces?
Well, we'd certainly want the police chief and town council at a minimum involved. And okay. I know that I did learn this morning that one of the members of town council spoke last Thursday. And again, none of this have flowed through your office, my office. It's discussions that happened after or before as EBA meetings that count for nothing if I'm not physically there to hear it. So you say you're surprised that we don't know. I don't know how we would know. None of us were there Thursday. I wasn't there. I didn't get any emails. I didn't pass along any information to the board. If you had a discussion with ZBA, that's with ZBA, you should have the discussion with this board. So, yeah, we'll have to understand what it is they want. I now understand from a conversational standpoint.
Sure.
Is there a hearing part to this? Is this a public hearing that you have to have for this?
We would certainly
kind of
want to notify the abutters and have them present, whether it's probably not a formal hearing.
Okay. What timeline are we on, Bob?
Commissioners.
What timeline are we on now?
Well, you only have two more meetings this calendar year, and the 29th is busy, but...
What calendar are they on? There was
much faster. When's the ZBA finished? 15th?
December 15th.
December 15th, yeah. And that cannot be extended further, correct?
Without their...
Well, it can be. You guys can do that.
I guess you could.
Yeah.
So, honestly, your agenda on the 29th is already packed.
Yeah.
Maybe we have to add another meeting because the 15th isn't fast enough.
I'd be willing to add another
whenever
meeting.
Whenever you meet
well, in December. Maybe when we do the appointment, we can
we meet the 13th,
extend the meeting
think,
and do this. Yes, we're all together.
Which?
For the school committee.
That's the meeting, the 29th, that's got a really
busy agenda.
Oh,
we're
going to
co-locate that.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you're going to do that here.
The 29th is...
You may have to add a meeting.
The 29th is wall to wall.
Pretty packed.
And we can't do anything out of any of the town meeting times, because those are all jammed.
Not really.
No.
Unless we did it 7:30.
Just do a special meeting, which I'd be fine with.
But you really need neighbors to have an opportunity to see you.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. We're doing this in the auditorium.
Well, it just gets back to, I mean, we couldn't advise them not being aware of what it was that we were talking about. I mean, and, you know, if we needed, you know, 40 minutes instead of 15, then we could plan for that. I mean, you know.
Yeah, I apologize.
It's just kind of about a mutual respect thing, that's all.
Since we didn't know the again, we just didn't know how this all even worked, so we should have, I mean, it was more just how the process worked.
Wait a minute.
It strikes me that you guys are very experienced developers.
Wait a minute. You've been doing this for how long? Can you tell us here that you don't know how this works?
On a request for a service zone, I have not done a request for a service.
But you guys have come before how many boards? All we're asking for is a heads up, and an email's fine. Copy the town manager. He'll get it to us. There should be no doubt about what the meeting purpose or the objective is. There should be no surprises. I'm shocked when I hear I had no idea. That you guys own the agenda. You guys own the subject matter. We don't.
So, we know where we're going. We're going to try to, you know, we're going to get what we're going to get from you, and that's going to be good. It's going to be welcomed. We've opened a dialogue. That's good. I think I understand what you are asking from the highway commissioners. I mean, so, and I think you're going to formalize that in a little narrative, saying this is what you're hoping for from us. And we're going to have to try to fit it in as quickly as we can with the idea, as John Arena said a little earlier, this is not about trying to be an obstruction. Actually, it's quite the opposite. I mean, you know, between several members of this board and other boards, we've been trying to really help you get to this, get to yes, so that it works for everybody. So I think that's where we are. Bob, am I missing anything here?
No. No, just as soon as possible.
Yeah, that would be good.
Put together a packet of some sort, or you know, if there's existing documents that would fulfill that purpose. I was familiar with the topics, but have no idea on the details.
We'll get that to you tomorrow.
Good. Now, the ZBA is in session. Is there commentary or interest, or you're here just to hear it all from our perspective?
Probably a little both.
Yeah.
I would just point and I know the board probably has or should have a memo put out by town staff indicating that the ZBA provided some guidance and feedback on certain requests for waivers, and we just the Board of Selectmen could get a flavor as to where the ZBA made certain recommendations and some certain guidance as well when the Board of Selectmen are considering the issues before them.
Great. Okay.
That's a wrap.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Gene, you want to bring us up to date on...
Yeah, I understand we're a little behind, so I'm going to go quickly and kind of skip over.
Okay.
Just pictures.
I'll cut to the chase. How's that?
There you go. All
right. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about 40Bs. And I know everyone knows what a 40B is, but I'll spend a couple of minutes talking about the technical definition. We talked about the housing market earlier, and it's no shock that we have a robust housing market. And, you know, the numbers are, these are a little bit older numbers, but it's up there, and Reading is very attractive. A couple of things from the housing production plan. And for those of you who aren't familiar with the housing production plan, the state doesn't technically require, but strongly urges cities and towns to have a housing production plan. That's our roadmap for how we're going to meet the state mandate of 10% affordable housing. And I'm going to show you a map in a minute that highlights what other communities are doing with their housing production plan and where they are. But a couple of things from that plan that was done in 2013, and it's a five-year plan. 22% of the households in Reading would qualify for some type of subsidy. And I think that's a telling statistic. When you think about Reading, you don't really necessarily go to that as an assumption of who's living here. So we have definite pockets of need, and that's a higher number than I would have expected. The second thing I wanted to point out is that obviously the senior population, which we're spending a lot of time thinking about and planning around, is expected to increase by 57% from 2010 to 2030. That's a pretty big number. This graphic shows you across the state which communities have housing production plans, which ones have been expired. So the greens, which we are, I know this map's a little hard to read, but we're up here in the green. We have a current approved housing production plan. So we're doing everything we can to be proactive and plan for housing as the state requires. So that's good. The pinks are all the expired housing production plans. So those are the folks that have fallen behind. And the yellows are the certified. And certified is something I'm going to talk about in a minute, because certified is good. That means you basically have a timeout from 40Bs.
Doesn't mean you've achieved. It means you've
got you have a pause.
You hit pause.
Yeah. No color means they don't have a plan?
They're just not doing anything.
No.
They're not coming to the dance.
Does certified mean that you that the state acknowledges that we are making a good faith effort to achieve it? Or what is that?
I'm going to talk about that in a minute. Okay. Hold that thought.
Gene, another question which you may want to hold on. So for 5 years now, I've heard about 10%, but it occurred to me the other day, do we really need to be the leader of that pack? Or is it enough to be in the center of the pack that there are those that are maybe more accelerated than us and others that are behind us? What's the downside to being just okay in that dimension?
Yeah, I mean, it depends what your goals are. In our housing production plan, we said, look, we know we have needs for affordable housing, but we also know that we have this obligation to meet 10% per the state mandate. Because we fall below that, we're subject to 40Bs. So once we get over that 10%, we're now, unless we want to do a friendly 40B, there's no comprehensive permits by the Zoning Board of Appeals.
So it's more the challenges raised by 40B. It's nothing the state is necessarily going to do. There's a lot of red on that chart before, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
So they're not doing anything necessarily going after half the state.
No. No, it's just a question of, do you want to be vulnerable to these types of projects?
Especially when we're trying to now plan for kinds of how we want to use land and how
right.
we want to maximize economic development, to have somebody come in and say, no, we're going to do it this way, and we're hamstrung.
Right. Right. So. We lose control with 40Bs.
Okay, thank you.
This was an early win back in 2011 where the state actually denied a 40B proposal. I'm not familiar with this happening a lot of times, and we talked about it a little bit back in 2011, but they actually said no, which was...
Here or somewhere?
Here. Yeah, it was up across from the fire station.
Yep. I knew a little bit about that.
So that was, I'll start off with the positive, that was an early win. And they credited us, and the town should be proud, for proactively planning, and we have two smart growth districts, one in the downtown and one at the Gateway, where Reading Woods is. And, you know, those are not easy things to do. It requires a two-thirds affirmative vote of town meeting. So Reading's doing, I think, everything they can do, and they acknowledge that it really wasn't a great proposal. So there's the good news. We've done lots of planning. I won't go into all the minutia, but we're still below 10%. 40B, it is a law, and it's a state mandate that says you have to have this 10%, and as part of that, they have to have between 20 and 25% of the units with long-term affordability restrictions. So I worked in a community that had a lot of mobile homes, and we said, great, these are affordable housing units. And the state said, no, not unless you have a deed-restricted unit do you get credit for that mobile home. So there's a real technical piece of this that doesn't matter if there's apartments and the rents are really low, so that's affordable housing. No, it's not. It's got to have regulatory agreements. This is just some more background. The numbers here have been updated. This is what was in the packet, so I wanted to just highlight that. So when we talk about affordable housing, I really like to say that it's workforce housing, because it's people who are earning for a one-person household just over $51,000, for a two-person, $58,450, and for a four-person, $73,050. That's, in my mind, workforce housing. Again, what does this process with 40B involved. The zoning board is the authority that grants this permit. The comprehensive permit does not waive the whole list here, building permits, state highway permits, Wetlands Protection Act. So even though they bypass zoning, there are a lot of things that they don't bypass. And again, it's the year-round housing stock that must be affordable. It's kept by the state. It's called the Subsidized Housing Inventory, so you see the SHI all over the place. Reading is currently at 7.78. Now, the point that, how do we get to this safe harbor, the certification, the yellow in the map? If you create 0.5 or 1%, half of a percent or 1% in a single year, you can request the state the safe harbor protection and say, please, give us a break here.
How long is that good?
How many units is that for us?
I'm coming up to that.
9,800.
But before we get there.
How long is the certification status good for?
It depends. If you're half a percent, it's 1 year. If you can do a full percent, it's two.
Okay.
So these are the projects, the 540Bs that are in the queue. And I'm going to give you something better than that. This is 45 Beacon is 10 units. It's a bunch of townhouses. That's a little bit better map. It shows you how close it is. So that's kind of tucked in. It's up by the water tower. There's a long history behind this. It's a very old permit. I just pulled out an email, actually, from Jesse. and we sent them a letter right at the end of Jesse's tenure last year. And we checked with town council on what we can do to, because it's basically, it's a vacant lot with a chain link fence around it. They moved some dirt around, but there's really been no activity. So we do have a path forward with town council's help to see if we can kind of get these guys to either decide, are they going to develop it or not, and let's move forward.
Do they run out of time at some point?
They're covered under the Permits Extension Act, and their protection just ended at the end of October of 2016.
So they're out of time. They're done.
Yes and no. The town council, I'll defer to him on this.
Welcome to Massachusetts.
Yeah, it's about as clear as mud.
Stunning.
As long as they move
a pile of dirt around, then they're still.
So we're working with town council to wrestle it down.
So would this be considered a friendly in that, you know, it kind of fits into the neighborhood? People aren't going
it's
nuts
not,
or
no. No, this one was a long, right. drawn out thing with litigation. And but we're going to try and figure out how to make it unstuck. The second one is Lyle Estate. This has another colorful past. Lyle Estates came to us a year or two ago and said, we want to be a subdivision. And they went through conservation. And as they were finalizing where the wetlands are and everything else, they threw their hands up and said, we're not going to be a subdivision anymore. We're going to be a 40B. Mm-hmm. So they filed for a 40B right around the same time as Reading Village.
Right here.
And the state came out and they said, well, it seems like Reading Village, it's near the train. That seems like maybe a better spot. And then we never heard back from the state.
Mm-hmm.
So fast forward to about 6 or 8 months ago, and they came to us and said, we'd like to be a subdivision again. And we said, great. And they said, we're going to be, 3-4 lots, whatever it was. And there were some issues. And Julie and I figured out how to make them a 4-lot subdivision. So I think they want to be a 4-lot subdivision, but stay tuned on that one.
So we're not 16, but 4.
I don't know.
But note the comment, Julie and I designed it for them.
So are we getting the developer fee in there?
No.
But it's not a 40B.
It's better than a 40B.
Right.
So did the state push back, you think?
We never
heard
from the state.
Never answered, so.
My phone hasn't rung.
You knew it was them?
Yeah.
I can't say what I'm thinking.
I know. I couldn't make it up if I tried. So this is Reading Village that we just talked about. That's number 3. And the public hearing is scheduled to wrap up December 15th, and then there's 40 days to issue the decision. So if this all goes according to plan, sometime in the first quarter of next year, we expect to see a comp permit.
Number three. So the period ends December 15th?
That's where it is right now. Oops,
yeah.
Could always
change.
They
need action from us prior to that time?
Unless they grant an extension, right.
Well, they just said they wouldn't. They just, I asked them.
Yeah.
They won't.
They won't. It sounds like they won't give any more time.
Then we have.
What happens if we end up at stasis where we are today?
Then the ruling happens on the basis of the facts we have.
Interesting.
Then we issue a decision. So then we issue a decision based upon the information that we have.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And we have 40 days past the 15th to file that decision with the clerk.
So.
Hearing on the 15th.
I mean, is it a tactic that you just don't?
Yes.
Care?
It could be.
Appears like a tactic to me, but number four.
Okay, moving on.
Good news here.
Schoolhouse Commons, this is the school for St. Agnes.
Yep.
20 units. We got the application over the summer. Before the end of the summer, we gave our comments back to Mass Housing Partnership. And I ran into a colleague of mine at a meeting a month ago or so, and she said their letter of approval is coming. So
the closing happened about a week ago Friday. Did you know that?
No, I didn't.
But Father Rock announced that to the parish.
Okay, yep. So that's moving forward, and that's 20 units. And they're going to be reusing an existing building, so.
Yep, local owner.
And they've
owner.
Been in here a couple of times.
They've
been very
in
forthcoming.
Yep.
And
yeah,
those
use of the building, too.
Yep, so that's number four.
Yep.
And then number five is what I like to refer to as El Grande.
The big
grande.
big
enchilada.
This could be the biggie. Details are still being worked out.
Seriously, bigger than Running Woods?
I'm not sure.
Yeah.
In
not
that,
sure.
In that ballpark, though, right?
Yeah. I don't know
we'll
about
see.
Running Woods, but.
100 million. Careful,
but we'll see. We're calling it El Grande because we want it to be big, which probably sounds really strange, but. I'll get to why we think that's a good idea. This is the site, and again, here's a better map. It's these are the apartments on Lakewood, and then there's a parcel here, and then three lots here. You might recognize Jordan's Furniture, Home Depot, the golf store, and all of that here. We've looked at a lot of different ideas for shared parking, what we just talked about, and it's going to sound crazy, and maybe it is crazy, but. All of this parking sits here pretty much vacant for a good part of the
3 days a year it's busy. Yeah.
So again, Julie and I pretended
it's
we were designers and thought about a footbridge over and you know, they looked at us like we had 12 heads, which maybe we do, I don't know. But anyway, we're exploring all kinds of outside of the box thinking. So more to follow on that. I don't really know
so
a lot.
So is that yellow box the proposed?
It's one, two, and then these three. It's more than the yellow box.
But no change to the existing apartments. Value.
No, these would stay, and then everything beyond.
So how many units you get on that? It doesn't seem like it would be.
Bob just said 300.
Really? Yeah, that must not be.
Possibly.
So they're apartments, so they won't assess out at the same rate as if they were condos.
Right. But you're going up high, though.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because you have
wall.
Such a grade difference here. It's.
So, Gene, safe harbor. How many we got to have in
okay,
a year?
Let's get to the chase. So,
sorry.
I'm with you. So, unfortunately, even with the two 40Bs that are pretty much sure to be happening in the short term, we still don't reach 10%. So even with Johnson Woods, which is another seven units, which I didn't talk about, but Johnson Woods has a third large multi-apartment building going up. So we'll. I don't know when those units are going to be done and when they'll come on the inventory, but I threw in the seven units just for argument's sake. And then the 72 from Reading Village and the 20 from Schoolhouse Commons. And again, we're just still not there. We're short 113. So getting to the safe harbor. 48 units is the 0.5%. So it's based on the 95-84 total.
Mm-hmm.
If we can get to 48 units in a year, we can get certified for 1 year.
You do that with Reading Village, though, right?
We do that with Reading Village. Yep.
And your point earlier, if you get to 958 with the addition of, say, 300, you're done. It doesn't matter what else happens.
That's the big kahuna. That's the big kahuna.
In 2020,
yep.
When they raised the number of denominator.
So
denominator goes up.
Yeah.
The sort of good news is it looks like if everything goes the right way, we've got that 1 year safe harbor. But the even better news is that if we can, the very last point, get a very large 40B, because again, that denominator, it's a false positive that we're there. We're there, but we're not there.
Yeah, they'll reset it every 10
resets,
years.
Right.
Every 10 years it resets.
Right.
So now we get the new denominator, you know, it's not going to be that same number. It's not going to be 9584. It's probably going to be another, could be another 1,000 units.
When do the units count?
We're putting those units in.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, we've been systematic. This is the one thing, Dan, you and I have talked about, is that that number, when you keep doing what we've been doing for our growth, you keep pushing that number out in front of you.
Yep.
So, you know, it's like chasing your tail.
Yep.
Don't ever fall behind.
Yeah, you can't ever slow down.
Right.
Which is an issue.
So we got to catch up to the 113 plus. That's why the 300 big kahuna, the El Grande, hopefully, as I say, if it all works out as planned, gets us over the hurdle and we're there.
When do they count in the total? When are they done? When they're occupied?
CO.
Well, the state doesn't make it crystal clear.
So that depends.
But what they say is when you issue those comp permits, you can apply to have them added to the units. The caveat is if the project doesn't get started within 18 months, they can pull them off the units.
Evidence they do that?
Yes. Yep.
So not only is getting to 958 interesting, but getting things underway that would get you to 958 is even more interesting.
Yep. There's always a kind of a catch with the state.
Back to the map.
There's more than a catch with this one, the state.
Back to the map. There's a parcel that's in the middle there. Is that part under discussion as well? You see that kind of.
This one?
No, there's like a.
Reviewed.
Oh, this one?
No, the keystone shape, the big piece of property. Move your mouse to the northeast.
I think that's all wet.
That's all wet. Right there. Is that wet?
All wet.
That's
I've walked
scenarios
it.
That are horrible.
You can actually see it.
Quicksand.
Wet.
Like water.
Yep.
Oh.
Yeah, we walked this whole thing.
Okay. Thank you.
Do we know if there's anything at the state level that they're discussing, reviewing 40B, where it currently is, what they see it being in the future? Any modifications or changes?
You know, they have a couple of little things in the pipeline, but I don't think it's going to be anything that's going to make it easier on for the town of Reading. You know, the business about, we don't have any mobile homes, but that always tends to percolate at different points. You know, the sad part is we adopted that zoning 2 years ago to allow the accessory dwelling units.
Have we gotten
so
any?
We have. Not a lot, but we have. So now we have the ability to create affordable housing just by having intergenerational living and having it be allowed.
What about current apartment buildings? Is there, if technically the owners were willing to, could you have those, have certain amount in those buildings be
reclassed?
Yeah.
I mean, we've talked about it. You know, there's a couple of moving parts on the subsidized housing inventory, and not to bring up a negative, but the housing authority has had a few units that we've lost.
Right.
And we've talked about, we'll do the work, we'll pay for the legal work to get those units back on. It's just a matter of a new regulatory agreement, because these were old regulatory agreements, and they just aren't interested. And that's a little disappointing.
Can we stop there for a second? I mean, we have a housing authority that, by its charter, is to maintain affordable housing, and yet we're losing affordable housing because of some type of...
And they're not interested.
Explain to me why is there any recourse this board can have?
We brought in town council on this.
How many
we had the
lost?
Same reaction.
How many have been lost? Can you quantify it?
10 or 12.
Over the course of what time?
Past few years.
That's 10% of what we're short.
Yeah.
So
their objective is not to maintain a level of 10% or greater. Their objective is to maintain what they have. That's the way they're
sort of.
That's the way
they're not supposed to lose any along the way, right?
Ideally, that would be great if they didn't. But that their mission is such. If they lose one to save more,
who do they report
to help the others? Then that's their mission. So it's an interesting question.
Don't we appoint boards members?
Can our legislators help with some guidance?
Affordable housing is the topic that I find most frustrating to our legislators as well.
Yeah.
They have the exact same question marks over their heads as we all do right now in this room, quite honestly.
We've had this discussion about a year ago.
Yeah.
And it was not fruitful.
No, it's very frustrating.
And it is frustrating, Barry. You're right.
Is it?
I'm not sure that you're maybe
Were you here when we had this discussion with them? We had them in.
I think I just got on. Yeah.
It's a very frustrating topic. It's almost unthinkable, actually, that that could be happening. But okay. I actually think that's pretty good news, though, Gene.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's like we're getting into.
We're getting close.
Yeah.
We're getting close.
I just don't want it to be like Lucy with the football.
5 minute recess. Five minutes.
Okay. I know we're running a little late. Got to take. Yes.
Sorry, Mr. Chairman. Before you take a break,
can
we adjourn the board?
Yeah. You certainly.
No. Before you adjourn, Mr. Chairman, can I convey my personal thanks for all the important work your board is doing? I think you've stood us very well in this whole 40B process. We're respected at the state level because of the careful and fair work we're doing. And thank you again.
Thank you. I agree with that. I echo that. Okay.
We would have said the turd in the punch bowl.
I've been saying that.
You can't keep chasing housing. We have to lose
honestly,
housing.
You know something, Kevin? You're singing to the choir. This is something that
we're chasing the wrong way.
You barber stores, they won't be up until February.
Because you aren't chasing it.
So, Victor, I'm going to ask Brad for you.
Okay. I got to do a quick downstairs thing.
This is who is
Brad.
No, who is the state?
The head of the whatever it is now. Not like Jay Ash is the head of economic development housing. This is the group that decides on affordable housing. They don't report to government. They report to themselves.
Really?
Yeah. They set their own rules.
Who appoints them?
I don't know.
Governor Shousel?
The honest answer is you saw her map of yellow communities. When there's enough of them, they'll just change the rules. But there's so few now, they don't have to change.
I was shocked at the white. Like, where's the fairness?
40Bs and economic.
Oh, that's true. That's true.
I'm just like you. Let's go.
Pull that ripcord.
So
let's roll with
report
it
and look at some of the details there. Oh, yes, it's that
come on, folks. Let's be it here.
Yeah, Jesse covered a lot of stuff that may or may not come up.
That's okay.
So, you know, I definitely showed him the Wakefield chart. The Wakefield assessor? Right there. So you might get some questions from me.
Exactly.
Should we just raise the rate? That was in fact just
if we ever
haven't heard anything from them,
we've got aggressive.
We haven't heard from them by our meeting this week.
Okay.
I suspect they're probably not that interested.
Yeah. I was talking to him about his outside.
He said he was going to give out free juice.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Black Friday special, right?
I'm interested to hear about that Randy Whitson project.
Yeah. We need a big rock. It's a little diamond. I'll take it.
Small diamonds.
Yeah, small diamonds.
Yeah, crack the window. They have the AC on.
Yeah.
You know, me, her son, if you're a rock, you know,
developers, you want to talk to your sister, husband,
you know, Tom Connery standing in the back there to the west.
Yeah, I know. Yep.
So I said you're going to get to know Andrew. He'll come tonight just for that reason.
He's the one doing the school, I think. I think he had an interest in it.
He signed in the last document, legal document, December, so he doesn't want to see the bar in there for the quarter. He's got a really good partner out of Danvers. Deep, deep talk. He knows she said it's excellent.
When you're out there, he's 15 degrees.
High end.
Yeah, you know.
Restaurant, maybe.
No lemon? They're small but feisty.
Bob, she did. That's a gravel project.
You know, you just got a snapshot.
I know.
Aside from the data that we have, the qualitative information she's got, I went on one site visit and my jaw dropped for 3 hours.
Really?
I don't know how she's going to summarize all this, though.
A lot of it's going to be anecdotal.
But it's given Andrew a great foundation.
And identify the opportunities.
I think we should get going. Oh, we're waiting for John?
Yeah.
Oh, he's here.
Well, John's here, right? He's right there, yeah.
We're going to call ourselves back
night,
to
Andrew.
Order.
Good night.
Good night, Andrew. Good night. Thank you for joining us. And Victor, I think the floor is yours.
Oh, no. Do we have to do
the hearing?
Oh, hearing.
Oh, we got to do the hearing. Sorry.
Yep.
To the inhabitants of the town of Reading, notice is hereby given that a public hearing will be held in accordance with the Mass General Law Chapter 369 of the Acts of 1982 on the issue of determining a residential factor and assessing the percentage of tax burden to be borne by each class of property for fiscal year 2017. The hearing will be held on Tuesday, November 15, 2016 at 8:30 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass. The five classes of property involved are residential, open space, commercial, industrial, and personal property. A copy of the proposed document regarding this topic is available in the Town Manager's Office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass., Monday, Wednesday, Thursday from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., Tuesday from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m., and is attached to the hearing notice on the website at www.readingmass.gov. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing or by email prior to 6 p.m. on November 15, 2016 to Town Manager at ci.reading.mad.us by order of Robert W. Lasher, Jr., Town Manager.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, members of the Board of Selectmen, members in the audience, members at home. I'd also like to recognize two of my board members who can make it this evening, Frank Golden, our chairman, and Steve Crook, board member. Robert Marshall is away on business and unfortunately couldn't be here this evening with us. Well, this is our 2017 version of tax classification for the town of Reading. We're here tonight to discuss the required actions by the Board of Selection, which is, I've hammered home, selection of a minimum residential factor, selection of a discount for open space, granting or not of a residential exemption, and granting or not of a small commercial exemption. The minimum residential factor. Reading has never adopted a split tax rate, which means in our case, the minimum residential factor will be one. And the calculation for that is taking the tax levy divided by the total value times 1,000, which yields our tax rate. So if we take 64.9 million divided by roughly 4.6 billion, we come up with an estimated single tax rate of $14.04 for all classes of property. This year, the average single-family home value will be $533,500. Table below summarizes what the anticipated tax bill would be for that average single-family value at various shift intervals. So right now, or typically, at a CIP factor of one, at a shift rate of one, residential tax rate would be $14.04, and the estimated tax bill would be $7,490. You can follow down and do the math in your head how much a shift you know, changes that tax amount. And this is just a little chart showing the average single-family tax bill history and changes from 2007 to 2017. And a tax rate note, total amount of the fiscal 2017 debt exclusion is just a hair over $3 million. This adds 65 cents to the 2017 tax rate and $346.76 to the average single family tax bill, and a little over $1,000, $1,015.95 to the average commercial property valued at $1,563,000.
So, yes. So if we adopt, let's say, a CIP shift of one, that's a rate of 1404. But really, when the homeowner gets their tax bill, it's really 1404 plus the 67 cents.
65.
Or is it 65? Or is that included in the 1404?
It is included in the 1404. Sales activity for single-family residential properties. In 2014, we had 234 sales versus 248 in 2015. Days on market were relatively, you know, the same, changed by about half a day from 41.8 to 42.2. But the average sale price in 2014 was just about $520,000. And 2015, the average sale price was $553,500, an increase of approximately 6.5%. Am I right on that?
you are correct on that, but they're misleading the days on market numbers.
I know. Nice to throw in there.
Yeah, I know.
The average commercial property valuation, now mind you, we have commercial properties valued as low as $220,000, all the way up to in excess of $23 million. The average commercial property value is $1,563,000. Add a factor of one, tax rate of 1404. The estimated tax bill is just under $22,000 at $21,945. This chart also shows you what it would be, the effect of the commercial tax rate based on any potential, you know, shift. Now, commercial properties, we have, let's start from highest to smallest. I mean, there's only six properties in town valued over $10 million. There's only 22 properties from $2 million to $10 million. And from $1 to $2 million, there's 34, which means there's 55 from $500 to $1,000 and 81 under $500,000. So, I mean, average is the average of the class. I mean, if you really wanted to take a look at an impact, you could look at these segmented for each category. In the average commercial tax bill history from 2007 to the present, if you look at basically the past 5 years, been relatively stable, right in the ballpark right there.
Actually, it's zero.
If you were to...
From 12 to 17.
Interesting. Learn something new every day when I read this. Any questions about that part first?
I just think that the problem here is the average is so skewed,
right,
by the amount of smalls and the amount of bigs.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you almost have to drill into each one of these things,
yep,
to understand the tax implications. And then, you know, by extension, what are those businesses and so forth? And, you know, are they qualifiers for any exemption? I think the last time we looked, there were 43 potentials out of 265 businesses. So, you know, I mean, it's valuable to look at the averages, but somewhat misleading in the discussion. So.
And you know, our previous discussions with this, we actually got down to a lot of good
detail. Yeah, last year, you had it broken down
each
of these categories.
In our pre-classification meetings that we had over the summer, I think we had a lot of good detail on that.
Victor, could you walk me through briefly just the, when it comes to the average commercial tax bill? So is it, it's completely market-driven factors? Is that what we're talking about, why it's been steady over a period of time, not really increasing, decreasing by a whole lot, like Barry said, from 12 to 17?
Well, there are a couple of things. Even. You know, the average commercial value has been pretty stable.
Okay.
It hasn't moved much. The residential side of the ledger has increased dramatically. Home sales are up.
Right, because that's purely driven off of sales numbers, right?
For commercial properties, no.
No, I mean for residentials.
Residential,
just sales, and commercials are set up a little differently, right?
Commercial, you're required to use the income approach to value. It takes into consideration market income, potential gross income, minus expenses, management, things like that, and capitalization rate.
So is that a form that, and this is what the state mandates that you have to go by, right? Okay, so is that a form that the state came out with as a, and maybe if you can answer this, great, but if someone has the answer to this, is that a form that they use to say, we're trying to keep the businesses, we're trying to keep the businesses, essentially. We don't want to get to the point where things are raising so fast that it's past what their income is.
Nope.
What's behind, what's driven behind that calculation form?
The motivation for buying and selling commercial property is income.
Right. What's your NOI?
From an appraiser standpoint, that's the proper approach to use. I mean, there are three approaches to value. Sales approach works for residential properties. Income works for commercial. And you have the replacement, cost minus depreciation method that I really don't get into.
But to follow up on Kevin's question, and we had talked about this when Jesse was doing her presentation. I don't think you were here yet. But it sounds like a lot of the data that you collect to sort of make your determination on income is voluntarily provided by the business owner.
Yes.
So, there's kind of a inherent inherent to underreport. And therefore, you can only go on what you're given. Obviously, you can do your own separate analysis and look at rents and come up with it. But the when Kevin sells a house, that goes to the registry of deeds. That 4-bedroom, 2-bath colonial, it's sold for this.
Mm-hmm.
And you can't hide that.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, you can gather information when a commercial property sells, right? But was that property at highest and best use? Was that, so you could go into that. But if the collection of data isn't mandatory, it's voluntarily, how do you kind of crack the code?
First off, we request income and expense data yearly. It's under the pains and penalties of perjury, whatever they may be. I kind of envision the Salem witch trials
depends on the individual.
Stocks on the common.
But we request that information annually. That information is, I try to verify it through looking at more nationally based sources, CBRE, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Because if someone's telling me, gee, I'm only getting $8.50 a square foot, and the market is calling for $36 a square foot, someone's lying. Now, there may be factors to why that person's only getting $8.50 a square foot, but the townspeople, other taxpayers, shouldn't supplant their mismanagement or whatever discounts they're giving to other properties. So we try to catch this annually by comparing what's submitted to us through national indices. Submitting income and expense data is actually a requirement, for if you don't, it can impede your rights to the Massachusetts Appellate Tax Board. Typically, if I set a value that you think is too high and you're a commercial property owner, I'm going to go, well, where's the income you gave me? And we make a couple of attempts, targeted attempts. We send out the forms, receive what we receive, send out a reminder, and then we may go through and send properties a registered letter. That registered letter, if they fail to respond, goes in the file. If they appeal my value to the Massachusetts Appellate Tax Board, I will have it dismissed. because they failed to, you know. So there are vehicles built into us acquiring data. Mm-hmm. I don't feel the need sometimes to chase down the small mom and pop, family-owned small buildings, because they're relatively simple.
Sure.
This is for the, you know, larger ones. That
more complex, yeah.
Hope I answered it.
No, you did.
Yep.
If it's owner, if it's the property's owned by the business owner, you don't. You're just going on business income. You're not looking at the rental income for the square.
I don't care about it's potential gross income, exclusive of the business. I don't. If you have a widget shop, I don't care how many widgets you sell.
Potential gross income.
You, I get this a lot. Well, I don't pay myself rent. Well, when you do your business income taxes, what do you tell the government on your taxes?
You what are you paying rent? Yourself?
Exactly.
On your, yeah.
And that's when, you know, the three monkeys come out, don't see, don't.
Yeah.
So that's when I go to the marketplace to determine what a reasonable rate would be.
Okay.
Discount for open space. We can define open space class two as land which is not otherwise classified and which is not taxable under provisions of Chapter 61A or 61B or taxable under a permanent conservation restriction, which land is not held for the production of income but is maintained in open and natural condition, which contributes significantly to the benefit and enjoyment of the public. I don't even know what that means. But should Reading decide, there can be an exemption of up to 25% could be adopted for properties classified as open space. I'm unaware of any properties that fit the description that aren't already covered under a 61A or B agreement.
I think every time this comes up, it's so minuscule, isn't it, the amount that we have?
It is.
I mean, just we don't have any.
I'm unaware of any in town that fit.
This is different than vacant.
This is 61 in protection for taxation. You give up your rights to use it in return for a low tax rate.
Mm-hmm. Like a farm or something.
Okay.
Well, after recent voting, there could be farming that we don't like coming here, right? May want to revisit just, this again down the road.
Begun to realize that.
Residential exemption. Board of Selectmen may adopt a resident exemption for all residential properties in town that are owner-occupied. An amount of up to, state law has given us the ability now to go up to 35% of the average assessed value of all residential properties, including vacant land. Adopting this would raise the residential rate to $19.98 from the estimated $14.04. This would apply to all residential properties before the exemption. The estimated break-even point is about $589,800. So that would be the break-even point. At $589,801, they're paying for everyone else's exemption.
Yes. The board, I will recall, we spent quite a bit of discussion on this a year ago, but I think Chairman Halsey and you worked out a better arrangement with the senior tax relief, so we've kind of put this on the shelf this time. Is that fair to say?
Yeah.
Adopted by only 13 communities, Boston, Chelsea, right. Cambridge, and Waltham. Shift is only in the residential class. Higher valued homes will pay for the exemption, right. And those homes are low value.
So essentially what that does is it takes every average home and reduces their taxes by 35%.
Below the break point.
Below the break,
below the break even point.
But as it turns out, I mean, the average home and the average property and the break point are pretty close.
It's not about 50,000 off. Yeah,
they're close together. Yeah. So, you know, I mean, you'd take half the town,
right,
roughly.
And the other half will take care of it.
And the other half will take care of it.
And to the tune of about $3,500.
Like the mm-hmm. senior, there was no means test applied to that. So,
correct.
Although, you know, there was a frustration. I mean, when we did the senior tax relief at town meeting, there was a little bit of frustration voiced by some people who said, hey, what about me? I've got four kids.
Yeah.
I just got laid off, you know. I need some help, and obviously, you know, obviously someone in that situation does, but, you know.
There are programs for that that are beyond our scope.
Right. So, I mean, it just, I'm not saying this residential exemption gets at that part. It's too inclusive. I mean, at least with the senior tax relief, we were able to kind of target it more specifically.
Well, what it's doing is it's making, you know, it's making somebody who has a more valuable property have to pay
you know, somebody's taxes who has a lesser value property.
Mm-hmm.
That's really what it boils down to. It's a redistribution of wealth, essentially.
See, when I look at the properties that do this, I kind of call it an urban owner occupancy incentive, because that seems to be where it fits, where you have a majority of residential properties, where there's a significant portion that are non-owner occupied rental properties that support it for, you know, the owner occupied properties. And everyone's favorite small commercial exemption, up to 10% of property value for commercial properties only, no industrial, no personal. Total property value has to be, cannot exceed $1 million. Not more than 10 employees, as certified by the Department of Employment and Training. One business in a building of several would qualify only if all other businesses qualified. Exemption goes to the real estate owner and not the business owner. And less than a dozen communities in the Commonwealth have adopted this exemption.
Did we, I mean, I know we talked at length about this last year.
Yep.
In combination of other things, but at that point last year, we kind of had a feeling about how many would and which ones they are. Have we gotten any more information in terms of how many properties in Reading and where they're located would qualify for this, to the point where it's even worth talking about?
We don't even know if they qualify. We know that there's 43 that potentially qualify
because of just their value under.
But that doesn't. That's not the,
yeah,
that's
the
qualifier.
The maximum.
That's the beginning.
That's like that's like get you in the door.
That's the opening.
Yeah.
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 But did we ever drill down to kind of either even anecdotally figure out if this would have value?
We're always around that 40 figure in properties that could potentially qualify, and that's coming straight from first pass of a list that the Board of Assessors uses for the purpose of determining whether or not someone qualifies. And as we talked about in prior discussions, you know, you could have your dentist as an example. It's a nice little building, $600,000, 7 employees. Well, he might have some payment mechanism where, you know, they're not reported to the Division of Employment and Training where they would appear in that report. So it's like if you went down the street trying to figure out, you know, would that person qualify? No, they wouldn't, because they might meet most of the criteria, but they're not on that list. And then you have others that are on the list that, you know, if office condos, for example, well, they have 20 of them on the list, but building value we know is more than $1 million. So we try to make a cogent effort to go through. I've never drilled down to say, here's who I think would qualify. Just, you know, come up with a rough number that could potentially qualify. That in all probability we get whittled down. Right. Push the
43 gets smaller. When we did this walkthrough a year or so ago, I mean, it was 43. I remember it very, very clearly. And, you know, just kind of almost right out of the chute,
mm-hmm.
about 25% of them were going to be taken off. So you were down in the 30 range, and you weren't done because there were other things that we would have to determine.
You know, the funny thing, when you look at this, the one of the biggest reasons why it doesn't make sense around here is because it just doesn't. None of these factors should be applying to any kind of municipality in and around the Boston area. It's not going to fit into this. It's a bad mold for this area. To have it less than $1 million, we're already over $1 million on our average, to have it less than 10 employees, and to have it one business and several would qualify only if the others did. If you put that all in dense areas, that's never going to happen. So it drives me crazy from a state level to see that we have these same regulations here as like Ashburton would have. It drives me absolutely insane.
One size fits all.
Yeah. I would argue, well, that 20, 25, 30 employees is a small business around this area.
It is.
I think it's probably designed more for like the quote-unquote mom and pop.
Again, but mom and pop is in a building with 8 other people. So
they're sharing a building. If
it's a horrible model for
this
area, you can't.
They all have to qualify.
Right.
This is one of those things from a state level drives me absolutely nuts.
And we just had this discussion tonight, myself, Steve, and Frank. This has been on the books for years.
Oh, I bet. When's the last time the $1 million figure went up?
Well,
never. Yeah.
Yeah, never.
Yeah.
Well, the lion's share of our commercial properties are assessed on that money, though.
81.
No. Yep. All right, sorry, my rant's over.
No, that's...
You're the property guy.
Hey. All right, here's the potatoes to the meat we just served up. Oh. Here do we stand up to our surrounding communities. Of our surrounding communities that we have here, Linfield, North Reading, Stoneham, Wakefield. How'd that guy get it in? Wilmington, Stoneham. Reading is the only one that has a CIP sector less than 10%. And I also like to include the shift factors so you get an understanding of, you know, where we're comparing apples to apples and oranges to oranges. Let's see, who beat us in Woburn? Okay. The Middlesex League, there for your perusal. Same kind of information. The, you know, what the residential share is, whether or not they split, what the shift factor is, average single family tax bill, and, you know, their tax rates. Largely residential comparable communities, fiscal year 2016 data. Again, previous.
So Winchester's really
Winchester
the only
does a reverse shift
that actually has a higher density of residential and a split.
Winchester does, oh goodness, they answered.
It's a CIP below one.
Right.
It taxes the residential.
Because they do, I think they put in their water bills as part of, so it's tax deductible.
They, yeah, that's exactly what they do. Yeah. That, good recall.
Put it in their water bills?
Basically what they did is that they put that in there so that you can deduct it. As a
oh, that's right. They have a negative. That's right.
Yeah.
A negative shift.
Right.
Yeah. Now I remember that. Yep.
So, let's see.
Well, that's interesting.
And, well, this one. That's all I'll call it.
Oh, is that the Piers? Yes, that looks like a Piers.
Yes.
Yeah, that's so.
Peer away. Again, same kind of information on it. Average single family tax bills, peer communities, as defined by whatever committee way back when. And helpful terms, levy, levy limit, override, oh, that's a bad word. Debt exclusion, capital outlay, so.
You need a snare drum for your next visit.
No. Yes. Okay, I'm happy to answer any questions.
So, I'll ask you specifically about Wakefield, because you also...
might know something.
I know.
Cover this. I don't want to give away trade secrets.
But not really exclusively to Wakefield. But look at Melrose, Stoneham, in particular, towns that you know border us, look and feel a lot like us in some ways. Although there is maybe a little more commercial property in some of those towns. How does Wakefield? How do the small businesses in Wakefield survive? I mean, you go down downtown Wakefield, a lot of the stores are just like ours. It's vibrant. How do they survive at a $27 per thousand tax rate, which is twice of what Reading does? And how does, I mean, there's got to be a disconnect in the way that those similar properties are assessed. Because if our businesses are struggling at a $14 per thousand tax rate, how does Stoneham at 22, Wakefield at 27, Melrose at 18, how do they do it? Is it the way they're assessed?
No.
So
Melrose, I was the assessor there for a couple of years. Their commercial sector is smaller than Reading. On par, I'd say it's around 8%,
right.
Even less.
But they're surviving with a split tax rate.
Yeah.
And so how are they doing it? And
well, Melrose is kind of like the Main Street model, you know, that they
yeah.
have a well-developed Main Street. We went through this in Wakefield, but Melrose has this, but behind those buildings, they have plenty of parking.
Tons of parking.
Yeah. And
Wakefield,
both sides.
Single lane in each direction.
Yeah. Wakefield is not without its issues regarding vacancy.
That's
but
correct.
As we've been able to determine, it's property owners that really don't, for whatever reason,
that they're not incentivized enough to rent their place. We have a guy that bought a building. He's had five major businesses to go in there. Perfect location. Will not deal on the rent while the tenant does the fit-up. Mm-hmm. Not even any concession there. These are people looking to pay $8,000 a month for a restaurant. But these small businesses there, they're just... I really can't answer it because it's not hasn't really been.
That's how they moved into town.
Yeah,
most of them and began. Yeah. It wasn't a question; it was a fact.
Right. But I mean, they're still constrained by the same economic factors that our business community is.
Melrose isn't, not even close.
No, it's not at all.
We have there's three commuter rail stops in Melrose, including the Orange Line. It's a huge difference. Most of them stop close to downtown, as well, or the third one stops in its own little.
And the parking
Highlands area downtown. It's a lot
parking
different.
Differential is gigantic.
Yeah,
there's another There's another aspect too, and I remember this from Jesse's slides. Do you remember that flat CIP growth?
Yeah.
In Wakefield versus Reading, I think you have to take that under consideration too.
Look, go down Wakefield now. There's all these development projects going on.
It's mostly I think that's the big housing going up.
Well, that's some not, commercial it's not stuff down by.
Well, it's been flat historically with that kind of a.
Also, for what it's worth, no disrespect, having been born in Wakefield, I wouldn't trade Reading's downtown for anyone's.
Hmm. Maybe Melrose.
Them's fighting words. There's some other people.
Right. No, and that was borne out by this week when we were at breakfast. It was the head of the Mass Retail Association said you guys should be really proud of what you have here. Yeah. So
we are.
I guess my question is, and we have to. Come up with a factor is we have a great downtown, we have great businesses, but yet we have a commercial. Now, again, it was just based on the average, we didn't drill down to the various, but basically, in 5 years, the commercial sector hasn't paid, their taxes have not gone up, and residential homeowners have gone up close to 20%. And we just went to the community to basically ask for more money to run our town, and they told us in no uncertain terms no. Yet the homeowners' taxes are going up relative to the commercial. So I guess it's hard for me to wrap my arms around the fact that the homeowners are subsidizing the commercial property owners in town, and that they're basically keeping the tax rate the same while the assessments are going up much higher. It's a subsidy.
I think you have it backwards.
And other communities
so do you understand
are
the concept?
Working the same. Other communities are working with the same constraints and the same challenges, yet they're able to survive on a split rate. And so, again, it's.
You have to go back to your subsidy point. I mean, I know you understand the concept of cash flow. And equity. Now, what's happening for the residential person is that they have more cash flow going out on their taxes because the equity growth is outstripping the commercial properties in multiples and has been for years. So, I mean, the idea of one subsidizing the other is, in my opinion, doesn't hold any water for the simple reason that it's not a subsidy when you're building equity in the backside. So you're paying taxes, yes. You're utilizing services at a much higher level. And your opportunity for services range from, public safety to schools.
But everybody has those services. I mean,
the commercial property owner doesn't have all those services.
Well, I mean, when you have an excellent school system and people want to move here, that creates customers for the business community. So
that is correct, and it also creates wealth for the residential homeowner, which is the equity point I'm trying to talk about. So, the idea of having parity, everybody has their give and take. Yes, if you've got people moving here who are spending money, that's good for the commercial property owner. But if you've got property going up in value, you've got an equity buildup that's happening. So it's what pocket are you in? And that's really what this boils down to. And so the idea that there's parity in the tax rate, at least given the size split that we have right now, and all you have to do is I mean, you could talk about people close by, you can talk about communities that are our peer communities, and you look at them closely, you begin to understand that those that are in the 90s as a residential community are not splitting the tax rate for this very reason I'm talking about.
That's some of them.
Yeah.
Back in 2004, the state legislature allowed communities to extend their shift capacity. In Wakefield, for example, for a period of 5 years, escalating downward, we could go to 200%. Reading could have gone to 1.75. The reason for this, in the early 2000s, real estate was really, you know, flying, and commercial stagnant.
Yep.
So as you had this escalation,
yep,
in residential real estate values for those communities that shift, it created a reverse shift.
That's the downside.
Tax burden onto the residential properties.
Say that again, Victor. I'm not sure.
As residential properties went up, and commercial properties actually went down.
Correct.
The burden is shifting mightily.
Correct.
Onto the residential.
Okay.
So Mayor Menino, in his infinite wisdom, lobbied the legislature. We need a temporary fix because residential taxpayers are paying more and more. Commercial going down. So the deal was, you know, for a 175 community, go to 200% and then scale it back for 5 years. But in year five, you're going to be at 170%. Mm-hmm. Knowing the late great Mayor Menino, the urban mechanic as we do, we're never going to be stuck at 170. So my first year in Wakefield was, we have to go to 200. Look at the dynamics of what you're doing here. And scaled it back 5 years, we're at 175. So that's how communities used the tax shift to remain fair and equitable among the tax base. So.
Right. And we've chosen not to do that.
Yes, Bob?
You got to look at the other side, though, and that's risk. Look at Burlington. They have a lot more commercial, industrial, personal property, and they split the rate.
Right.
And when all of a sudden CIP cratered a couple of years ago, the residents got whacked with a huge tax increase, mm-hmm, that had nothing to do with anything new going on in the town.
Yep.
It's just that suddenly, because you had built this huge lever onto the CIP, it can swing in both directions.
Yeah, it's leverage.
So, that's an interesting point.
Yeah, but that tax bill's still half of it.
Yeah, so over 10 years it was probably fine, but try to explain that to the 65-70% residents in that 1 year where their taxes went up 12%. So, you know, it's a multifaceted issue.
Yes, John.
I'm not sure I'd use the word subsidy. It seems to me, if we started out on the basis that we'd use assessment to determine our rates, that we suddenly don't like the outcome, we change the principle that got us here. The principle was the assessment of what you own or the assessment of the value of the space you rent is what we'll assess by, and that's gotten us until the present day. Now, I take it that some of us might view that a rise in residential and no rise in commercial is an undesirable outcome. But it's not by conscious effort on the part of either group that happened. The residence property was more valuable. The commercial property wasn't. I'm not sure I'd change the conditions for assessment just because I don't like the outcome, unless there's something else going on. We went in with the principle. The outcome went a certain way by the market forces. I don't get how you shift it the other way. It almost, you have to pick a winner and a loser. You know, you talk about subsidizing. When we move that SIP rate, we're trying to pick a winner and a loser, and I personally don't know, once you leave the plane of we're all in this together, we all walked in the door at a certain rate, we're all going to walk out at a certain rate, where in that spectrum you go. You look at the table behind Victor, I'm struck by, and this is true on your other slides as well, that shift rate is not formulaic. It's randomly chosen. They're either even fractions, 1.75, 1.5, or 1.575. I guarantee you that was a 1.5 with another kicker to bring it up to another 3 or 4 points. They're arbitrary, but when we make a change, we shift the basis on which we got here, and we force the residents and the company owners to change how they manage and how they run their businesses. They didn't do anything to cause their assessments to be where they are today, I don't believe. So I'm not sure whether it's endemic upon us to say, we're going to now rejigger it so that one of you is now the winner in this conversation and the other one is the loser. We came in as a group, it's a community. We don't pick winners and losers, or at least I don't think we know how to. Most of the tools we have are pretty blunt force. We start playing with financials. It's pretty blunt, and it doesn't really discriminate as finely as you'd like, and I'm not sure we're smart enough to discriminate.
Well, we 2 months ago we picked, I don't want to say winners and losers, but we rejiggered. We basically said, as a community, we want to support seniors on a limited income, and then the rest of the town is going to support them.
And we gave the town
that wasn't a financial jigger. That was a piece of social engineering,
right? And
which is very different.
Well, I mean, but you still, some people's taxes go up and other people's taxes go down.
And we gave town meeting the chance to vote and discuss.
And when you open the door on that, you open the door for all tax policies. So you can't say,
well, everyone's entitled to that opinion.
Well, you can't say we're going to open the door on tax policy and then close it when you have, a discussion on classification. I mean,
of course I
you're
can.
Opening the door. Well, yeah. I mean, we have.
Absolutely
and we're going
to. Can't do that.
And we're going to, but,
we're talking about, hang on, we're talking about a comparison between protecting one of the most vulnerable segments of society, elders and seniors, who are enjoying their golden years, and we want them to because it helps us in terms of keeping folks in their home, versus a general need to adjust to sit between residential and commercial. In my mind, those are common only in that they both involve finance. They're two completely different assessments. You're correct in that they're both policy, but I don't think choosing one entitles us or motivates us or compels us to choose the other.
It opens the door. The town meeting agreed. So, I mean,
Town meeting has really no standing in this decision.
No, but town meeting gave us advice, and town meeting weighed in. It's up to us or whoever sits in these five chairs, whether it's this year or 5 years from now, to do it. And they weighed in and just said, this is, they gave us feedback.
Just to be very specific, Mr. Berman, this is your motion?
Yes, and it was for fiscal year 18.
Which, by the way, was not discussed with your board members prior to your going up. It was a big surprise to all of us. Okay. Yes, it is for FY18 at the earliest tax rate setting meeting after enactment of the senior relief statute.
But the motion's out of order. Town meeting has no role to decide the override amount.
I was surprised the moderator allowed that.
Given that's
he
why
was,
I stood
he,
up
he
at the
so
meeting and said,
"Meticulous about not
absolutely.
A long debate."
I ran it by the moderator.
You didn't run it by us.
He was quite inconsistent.
You got four other people on this board. This is a group. It's a committee. It's not a committee of one. It's a committee of five.
And I just brought it up and said, "We got feedback."
Town meeting, the only group
we got feedback. That's all it was. It was feedback.
Right, and you didn't invite any of the business community to give you their feedback.
I got 14
you got,
letters.
Great. Right. How many were at the meeting in that night and stood up?
I don't know how many people are on
zero.
Town. I don't know how many
zero.
Business owners are on town.
So it wasn't a discussion of peers. It wasn't a robust discussion.
I thought it was a fairly robust discussion.
Okay.
Well, that's neither here nor there because we have to set the FY17 tax rate, which my motion.
I'm responding to the comment that the door is open. I think we can do what we want, but I don't believe we're compelled or obligated to do anything.
No, but I just think that you were the one who brought up the idea of winners and losers. So when you want to shift tax policy to fit something that you want to do, it's okay. When someone else wants to talk about tax policy, to talk about equity and fairness, now you say we're not compelled. We can agree to disagree. We're going to set the tax rate. We know what it's going to be. I'm just laying out for the discussion.
I don't know what fair is, Barry. No. What is fair?
Well, I think that you're mixing apples and oranges here. In your motion, interestingly, the one that your instructional motion that you brought before the town meeting had, what it did is it tied a hook to anything that you do for the seniors. So your motion says that if and when the senior
and we hope it's next year.
Happens, well, I actually hope that it, I expect and hope, because our legislators are working towards it, that it will be signed into law before year end, which would cause it to go into effect in the next tax year, which would then give us the levers we need based on the design to be able to manage the risk. It was designed very systematically to do that. Now, how that connects to businesses
and how you would hold a business up in order to, you know, because there's senior legislation that's of a social nature, not a financial nature. I don't follow the connection of those two. However, you're right. We can agree to disagree. I do not see any connector to those two. Yet that was the motion.
Well, the motion was made specifically to basically, I think one of us said,
the motion's right there. He's got it.
I know. I wrote it.
I know.
So I think I know what it says. The idea was basically, I think, John, you might have said it earlier, we're all in this together. So the motion was designed that basically if and when, and we hope sooner rather than later, senior tax relief comes in, that the business community pay a bigger share of that. And I'm sure our friends in the business community would see the value of having seniors here and would raise their hands and participate in that.
So my motion
was tied to senior tax relief. My comments here tonight are still designed to say, I still don't have a good answer on how.
So you are picking winners and losers. So the winner is, if seniors win, then the commercial property owner has to lose. That's what I'm hearing you say.
I think we all win. I think we all win when seniors can stay in their houses. And so it's just a question of who's going to help pay for it.
Who pays for it is right. Exactly right. And so, as you well know, and as we have said, if and when the senior legislation is passed, which we expect to have happen, guess what? In order to make it even and fair, there will have to be a split. And it'll have to be a split because the way the law is written, only the residential can pay for the senior, and that's not fair either. So you have a split that actually causes no change. It causes parity, which is essentially what you see. I mean, Winchester has a reverse split in favor of the businesses. So, I mean, it's about parity. It's about fairness, right. I think. That's just my, I'm one person, I'm one vote.
You know, Victor, if we moved Home Depot around the lake, how much more taxes would they pay?
75% more.
Okay. There's your winners and your losers. That's the subsidy I'm talking about.
Okay. And so, is that a reason to take 160 businesses and put them at risk?
We just heard
so
this
that they pay more, because I got to tell you this. Here's what happens. Home Depot has a building full of lawyers, and that building full of lawyers petition through the appellate system every time that those taxes go up.
And we
it
know
never
Victor
slows
it,
down.
And we know Victor did an ironclad job in defending that assessment. My point is that you're right. We have blunt instruments. But the fact of the matter is that homeowners' taxes have been going up year after year after year. Larger businesses are paying significantly less because they're located in the town of Reading. So I'm not saying that we look at Wilmington, Watertown, Wakefield, Stoneham. They're in the 160s, 170s. A small shift in there will go a little bit toward equalizing that out. That's all I proposed last year. And yes, everybody's taxes would have gone up. Homeowners would have gotten a small decrease. But I'm just saying is that we've opened the door on tax policy, so we opened the door on tax policy.
Well, in a comparative way, and this was said earlier tonight about the taxes in Reading in a relative way to the peer communities. They're lower.
They're lower.
They are lower. And I know they've gone up. But I come back to the concept of equity. You know, it's okay to pay more for your taxes. It's okay to take a dollar out of your left pocket if you're putting $2 in your right pocket, particularly if one is a tax deduction and the other one's going to be treated in a long-term capital gain way. So, you know, everybody complains about taxes, of course. Nobody wants to pay taxes because nobody wants to send them to Beacon Hill or to Capitol Hill because it's a friggin' black hole, and we all know that. However, here in town, we look at it in a little different way. These are our neighbors. These are the neighbors that are the business owners and the neighbors that are our next-door neighbor and the kid who cuts our grass. I mean, and we have to have a certain element, in my opinion, of parity and fairness. And one shouldn't pay for the other.
Right. But unlike my home, which I get the equity when I sell it, if I'm a business owner, I'm making a living from my property. So there's a little bit of a difference there in terms of how you want to.
Yes, but the equity, their equity. So what happens is, yes, they have either a shrinking or a flat equity line. And that is what happens, and that's what holds the taxes down. The offset to that is that they do have cash flow from that piece of property that comes in. And, of course, it's taxed at ordinary income rates. So, I mean, we could sit and do financial models around this thing till our heads fall off. But what it gets down to is when you look at Reading and you look at the way residential communities are split and the way that the business communities are and the residential communities, and then you look at the target, and you know, I hesitate to use the names of any businesses, but that has come up. It came up, frankly, in town meeting. I think that your motion prompted I won't say an inappropriate discussion, but it prompted a discussion that was really picking winners and losers. And we were naming businesses and calling them out and saying we want them to pay more. Personally, if you got 10 businesses that you want to pay more and you're willing to take 180 businesses and slap them around just so you can get a bigger take from the 10 businesses, that doesn't seem like taking care of your neighbors to me. Yes, Victor.
I was just going to say on this chart with these various shifts, you'll see ones that look a little bit odd. Burlington is a 1.75 community. For whatever reason, their selectmen decide. They decide to go to 1.575. Melrose is interesting. When I was there, it's a 1.5 community, but through discussions with the commercial Chamber of Commerce and business community, they decided to use the shift to proportionally balance
the average
tax increases. So that's why Melrose doesn't come right at 1.48.
I could just ask Victor a question. Are the maximum shifts that each community is allowed more or less based on where they were historically at a certain point in time?
Yep.
So I think that's important to understand, that these communities all have, well, there's different caps. Some of them are at the same ones, but just like the formula for school at Chapter 70, at a point in time, someone fixed a formula. You are what you are, just like Prop 2.5. And going forward, now here's what you can do. So these communities didn't necessarily choose to go to 1.75 versus 1.48. You know, in this case, 1.5 is all they can do. So just understand when you're looking at these numbers, these are not necessarily free market choices by all these cities and towns.
You know, the other question in regards to that, Bob, from a historical standpoint, Victor, what are the age that all these places went from one to a split? How long ago was it? You know, do we have dates?
I've tried to find that, and I couldn't find it.
I'd be interested to see when it was. When anything split.
Wakefield, I believe, was within the first couple of years of classification.
It was like in the late 70s, early
80s.
So they went right off the bat.
And the other thing here, to be a community contemplating a split now for whatever reason is fine. But, you know, you asked the question, how do we survive in Wakefield? The answer is it's always been that way.
Right.
It's a given.
It's kind of where I'm going with that question.
Open the candy
it's baked
shop.
In the cake. Yeah.
You know, just given where we are as a community, given where we are trying to balance our budget, I think all of us would agree on any issue that comes about. It's what we always do is not always going to be the right answer. So, we have to just look and shift with the times and just say doing it just because we've always done it, I just think is not an appropriate.
Well, my reason for the question was more to see, you know, when did they do it? What was the circumstances around it? That's always what I'm thinking about. You know, at what circumstance does somebody say, I think the temperament's right, I think it's right to do this? You know, it's an interesting question to see. And I think that it'll correlate with, I'm assuming, what's going on with the economy at the time that it's done.
And to your point, Barry, and to the question you raise, at any given point in time, the town and a board of selectmen have got to respond to what seems to be the reasonable and fair thing to do. So, for example, somebody might wonder, the five of us have agreed in principle that based on our expectation of what the senior tax exemption will create in the way of revenue savings for those people, it's going to cause us, in order to keep a parity of one between commercial property owners and residential property owners, you'd have to probably go to a split of 1.02, 1.03, somewhere in that range. Somebody in another town is going to look at that chart and go, what was going on with those guys in Reading? Why did they do that? Well, because we were being responsive, actually, I'm one vote, but we agreed in a straw vote in principle that businesses should share equally to their size with the residential property owners to absorb the cost of the senior exemption. That, to me, what we really say is, in order to stay at one, we got to split the tax rate next year. That's so really what it's
net
saying.
Zero difference.
So it's a net zero difference to what you're sharing equally. And to me, that's what neighbors do. I mean, you don't overburden one over the other when you don't have the right environment to justify it.
I think when we saw the data from last year, when we had also a good discussion on it, the 1.1, 1.15 was not going to overly burden smaller businesses. Yes, the taxes would go up. And like you said, no one likes to pay more taxes, so it's going to be overburdened. But it would have been a way to kind of shift it to more with those with the ability to pay, which is exactly the same concept as senior tax.
It is absolutely not even remotely close to being the same,
Mr. Chairman,
at all.
We're going to agree to disagree.
No, then we can agree to disagree.
It's
just arithmetic, actually. It's not even math.
The real evil here is that taxes go up exactly 2.5% per year, and they will forever because our spending is beyond 2.5. That's the original sin. That's the problem. Providing a one-year adjustment impacts the residential class for 1 year, and after that year they're back on the same train of 2.5% a year forever. So it's not legitimate, not accurate to say it provides relief. It provides a sugar high in 1 year, and for everyone to understand the math, there's about 92% in the residential class, 8% in the commercial class. That's about a 12-to-1 ratio. If you apply 15% higher rate to the business class, you get about 1/12 of that comes back to the residential. They're going to get about 1.2, 1.4 cents difference. So it's not, and that's in 1 year only. And then after that year, you're back on that 2.5% a year. Relief is dealing with the spending, dealing with other sources of income. That's relief. Shifting the chairs around here 1 year is not going to. Doesn't really provide relief. It's really a misnomer to describe it that way. And I hear it from everyone. I hear two primary reasons. We're going to provide relief, and it's fair. I don't know what fair is, and I think the relief argument dies on its face. It doesn't hold. It's the incremental rate over year that hurts us, and which is baked into the cake. We're on this train for a long time to come. Time for public comment?
It is time for public comment. We're going to go around the mulberry bush here. Yes.
Mr. Chairman, Andrew Schultz, President of the Reading North Reading Chamber of Commerce. I believe the selectmen have all seen my letter. I want to state what I'm going to say, and it's probably a little bit harsh, but I think it needs to be said, because I think you guys need to know how the business community feels. The business community is your neighbors. We're all small business owners. I'm not here representing Home Depot and Jordan's. I'm here representing the shops on Haven Street, on Main Street, so on and so on. We feel sandbagged and betrayed that this was brought up at the town meeting. The business community, in my opinion, should have been advised that this was going to happen. A town meeting is a chance for a town to get together and share all views, pro and con, on any issue. We weren't given that chance. And to me, the agenda was set without us knowing that it was going to go on. I think that's wrong. I think that shouldn't happen again. And not to steal the word from Hillary Clinton, I think it's deplorable. Going to a CIP is like when you lose green space. You never get it back. I am not naive to think if it goes to 1.1, next year it's not 1.15, 1.2. Have you ever seen a federal program ever get cut back? It never happens. Once you go there, it's gone. Okay, and could we go back to that slide that shows the commercials pricing over the last 5 years?
Commercial taxes over the past 5 years?
Yeah, just commercial. I look at this right here, from here to here, 12 to 17. And Mr. Berman, you commented, and accurately so, their taxes haven't gone up. To me, that's playing chess, checkers, not playing chess. I look at that and say, why haven't these properties appreciated in the last 5 years? That's the bigger issue. You're going to keep chasing your own tail around in a circle unless commercial values appreciate at a greater rate. If Pulte Homes was Linfield Marketplace, would you guys still be in the same place fiscally right now?
No.
No.
Let's not make that mistake we made before. Driving businesses out of town by raising their taxes is the absolutely wrong approach. You're going to make the value of the property stay stagnant, Resi's going to go up, and you're going to have, the economy is just going to get worse. It's not, it's common math. I don't know why anybody can't see that. It's going to get worse and worse every single year. To me, you look at these properties, look at Portland Pie just went out of business. I've had two different small mom and pops, I won't name them, right locally, that have come to me and said, Andy, you know what? We used to get walk-ins. People were waiting for a table. They used to come and walk into our business. They're not getting that anymore. These people just getting by. They have triple net leases. What does that mean? You raise their taxes. It ain't the big landlord that's paying it. It's the small business owner. You know, what is that going to do? It's going to increase prices. Who shops locally? Seniors. The same people we're trying to protect are the ones that are going to get hurt by this. You know, we had a board meeting to discuss this in the chamber. We deal with this in Reading and North Reading. It's the same thing in North Reading. They have a tax rate as well. North Reading, surprisingly, has almost double the commercial tax base. I thought it would be the opposite when I first heard those numbers last year. Again, we want to be good neighbors. We want to be part of the process, but we don't feel like we were part of the process. And Mr. Brown, I'm not trying to call you. I'm just saying the people are upset. I just want to give you the feedback.
You know what? And I appreciate that feedback. Yeah. And I've also heard from people who were upset, who specifically said I didn't vote for the override because we don't have a split tax rate. So it's a, it came up, John, Arena, you brought it up and it came up from there. So let me just tell you the motivation for doing it. Five people set the tax rate in town, five people who sit in these chairs. We decided that it was important to kind of look at tax policy, to be one of three towns that did something that 348 towns didn't do, okay? And so it opened up the door for discussion on taxes. My instructional motion, and I emphasize instructional, it had no bearing, it had no weight. It basically just said, you know what, these are the issues that this Board of Selectmen, current Board of Selectmen, are struggling with. What do you think? Right? And there was a great, there was a great discussion.
Don't you think the business community, you should have called me or called the business community and said, hey, this is coming up? I mean, to me, to throw out a bomb out there at a town meeting, which doesn't even have the jurisdiction to hear that issue, it's just a way of poisoning public opinion without giving the other side the story.
It was,
I think the other side needs to be heard. I think that's bad.
And the other side is clearly heard. We do these hearings every year.
Well, they're heard now.
We get letters. Well, no.
92 people that aren't hearing it, Barry.
I apologize if I ruffled feathers.
They're upset, yeah.
But you know what? It was a discussion that needs to happen. And it's a discussion that's going to happen every year.
But it doesn't have to be an ex parte day. It should be with the other side present. That's my whole point. I'm not saying the discussion is not warranted. It is. We're having a discussion tonight. But I'm here to defend the business community. I wasn't then. And I think both sides need to be heard. I'm not saying you shouldn't have the discussion. We should let us know next time. That's all we ask. Again, the biggest issue is look at that middle call. That's the biggest issue. It's not, should we go to a split? It's why has that not increased where residential has? Well, I can tell you why. There's no parking.
Sevenless businesses.
Hey, you want to ask me that question?
I can, yeah, sure.
Okay. Where are your rents downtown? What are your average rents for space?
I don't know the number off the top of my head.
Okay, yeah. I do. All the things that you're saying about that, mm-hmm. that's what's communicated to me when the business community fills out their income and expense forms. I'm required to interpret that.
Right.
And it's not necessarily that business is down or what have you. It could be property owners charging a little bit more. It could be other economic influences.
I fill out the same form for my commercial property. I know what you're talking about.
That's governing that. It's not a conscious decision on my
part. No, it's just indirect.
I just want to make sure that
I
have no choice.
Reading's not
where the number falls.
No, this is not directed at you at all.
Okay.
So I don't want to even sound that way at all, because certainly not. And if it was, I would have no problem telling you. It's not. The concern is there's no parking. Okay. All these businesses on Haven Street, they go in and out. What's the main reason the parking is not great? You know, you have, I think there's certain areas on there that are like 1 hour or 2 hours or whatever it is. That's not enforced. You know, people park there all day. If you're not from Reading or North Reading, you don't realize there's a spot behind the old Atlantic where you can park. People from out of town don't know. Main Street, you try going to Venetian Moon on a Friday night, you're going to circle around five times looking for a spot. Mm-hmm. The parking's tough. That's the biggest issue why the retail doesn't make it. It's tough because we do have, like you mentioned earlier in the graphs, you got the big giant properties that are 10 million plus, I believe there's two of them or what have you. So the majority of them are under a million. You know, right there, you got 81 plus, it's 134 that are under a million. I would suggest in the light blue, I bet you a lot of those are multi-unit, kind of what we'd call strip malls, where you have three businesses put in the building. The thing about, mentioned about giving the small business tax credit, to me that's a popsicle headache. I don't know how you would enforce that or regulate it. I think it's just too hard. It's a very clunky statute. The big thing is, it just, all these people are, the commercial property owners, or excuse me, commercial business owners, they pay for their own trash, they don't use the schools, they don't use the services that the residential uses. They're getting hammered right now. It's hard with the parking that we have to get people to come in here. And I don't want to be redundant, but I just think it's the wrong time. And we just, if something's going to happen in the future, please let us know. We want to work with the town. We want to be good neighbors. You know, we spend a lot of money in town with the Christmas tree lighting, with the various events. We give money back. We just want to make sure that the board has our back as well. Thanks for hearing me out.
Yes.
Thanks. Mark Doxer from 110 Beaver Road, right here. I say my address. Mm-hmm. Couple of comments. Thank you for the feedback, very helpful. One thing, just as it relates to instructional motions hit everybody cold, right? No one in the room is prepared to have the discussion. That's why they're actually very difficult to have. So I understand it'd be nice to have a discussion with all in there, but no one knew what was coming. That's how instructional motions work. Yeah. But not that it was against one group or another. Everybody kind of got hit. And I think it did bring up some interesting discussions. So it is what it is, that's how it happened. Number two, I agree with your concerns. Why aren't those values up? And the parking issue, from my perspective, I keep hearing we don't have a parking problem. We have a parking problem. We do. They might be there, but nobody knows it. And they don't park accordingly, and it hurts the businesses. It needs to be addressed, and we can't keep saying we're okay. We're not okay. Number three, as it relates to this, Victor, I think it'd be very helpful to look at the median business, mm-hmm. and what the real smaller businesses would look like in terms of an increase if there was a shift. I think that the answer is going to be most of them, you're going to end up somewhere between $500,000 and $1 million in total. And the impact of a small shift, 2% up to maybe even up to a 1.1, is a lot less than what we see for a $1.5 million business. We really should see what it looks like. It would help to make that comparison. I do think it's time to consider what would happen from different commercial tax rates. 1.0 is where it's been, I agree, and I understand that. I don't know that we know the magic as to what it should be, but I do think that larger businesses in particular, and if there's going to be a second large project, should be paying more of their share toward what's going on, what's coming out of everybody's pocket in the town. And I think that it would go a long way to comforting people in the town that everyone is in it together, and that we, on a separate note, but related note, we have issues. We have a structural problem in our budget. We have cut items that are going up in cost faster than Prop 2.5 allows us to pay for. We all know that. None of these things are going to address that, unfortunately. The only things to address that are, number one, more business in town, which hopefully through our, sorry, the economic development coordinator, I'm looking for him, he's not here.
He's gone to work.
That's he's gone he comes to work. Back.
He's gone to work or he's left. No. He's heading back to New Mexico.
This is exactly what we should be doing. It's the right discussion. It took a lot of pushing to get it in place. We had some folks who didn't want it. We had some folks who did want it. I think it's great. I think it's exactly what we should be doing. I do think we have to have more discussion about what's happening, though, with the tax rates in general. But we need to understand what it really means. If it means it's going to be forcing lots of businesses out because their taxes are going up $10,000, you'll have to be joining that bandwagon as well, that it doesn't make sense. But I don't think that's what the reality would be from the small shifts we're talking about. Thank you.
If I might, John.
Yes.
I got a number of comments both from the residential and commercial sectors during the summer. When we had the listening sessions, and I believe I used those five groups for the commercial sectors and actually showed the impact of different overrides, it was very educational as opposed to an average business or an average commercial value. And in fact, you can look at the two lowest groups as homes, you know, up to $1 million home. It's the same. You got the same tax rate, so the same impact. It's only those properties, red, yellow, and small ones down there that make a difference. Yeah, Victor's sent me a note that he wants to go home right now. Oh, no.
That's on page two.
The median value of commercial is $340,000.
In that first column, the median value is $340,000.
Yeah.
About that.
Right. So, you know, let's forget what they're called. Let's just look at their assessed value. You know, the bulk of the commercial sector is very similar to residential in that sense. In the sense they have a tax bill, it's very similar to a residential tax bill. And then you move the envelope down here for the higher ones, and it's not at all similar to a house. I just wanted to say I got the comment from both sides, if you will, that to see the real numbers and to see how 70 or 80% of the commercial base was affected, it really wasn't that much on an override. It wouldn't be that much on a split compared to, say, in an average. And, you know, I agree more information is always better.
Yes.
Karen Kabalbachi, 494 Main Street. I'm here representing as a resident, but also with the Retail Association of Massachusetts and the Small Business Steering Committee of the National Retail Federation. To your point, way back, I think it was September meeting, you had said we have the residents in the town, but they don't work here, therefore they don't shop here.
During the day,
that's
right.
Counteracts your comment in regards to bring more residents. Because that's really, more residents doesn't equate to more residents will shop here. So please keep that in mind.
Well,
also, within the meeting that you were at that the Chamber of Commerce had put on with the president of the Retail Association, John Hurst, he talked about the issues that the retailers are facing, which is our unemployment insurance rates, our payroll taxes, all these things that continue to go up and up and up, really do hinder us. It was my main reason why I sold my brick and mortar and moved to an online business on top of my manufacturing business, because it helps keep my costs low. Retailers in Massachusetts have to pay time and a half on Sunday. That really hurts us too. And when you say be a good neighbor in terms of taking care of our seniors, our businesses are good neighbors to everyone. I can't tell you the number of times that I could have been in my store and have zero customers, meaning zero paying people, but at least five people who walked in looking for a donation. And we do, the businesses, by and large, support all the community organizations. Did everyone enjoy the recent Halloween walk? Mm-hmm. I mean, that was something that I had brought forward to the rec department 3 years ago, asking to bring more awareness to the businesses. That's businesses spending their own money to support the community. They support the Reading Educational Foundation, the libraries. So we are good neighbors, and we are not getting the same services that the residents get. So that's not an equal playing field. And to Mark's point, we do need more businesses, because more businesses brings competition, and that will help the other businesses. And that's, I'm so thankful that we do have the economic development person, because that really is the focus. That's what we need to see in this town. You get those numbers up and get real business, commercial business, not just retail, but whether it be a technology sector, something beyond. We lost Keurig to Burlington. Has anyone ever asked why?
I don't.
Yes.
Okay.
It wasn't the tax rate.
No, but that's it. These are the things of
campus.
It was the campus.
And that's it. So that's unfortunate. When we shot down having the Market Street, we should have said, fine, we won't have that. But rather than doing the knee-jerk reaction to residential, why don't we look at what else we could have in there, like a campus? So I hope that's what this economic development person is going to look at, besides just brick and mortars.
Yes, Nancy.
Nancy Doctor, I'm actually here really as a resident to basically voice my absolute opposition to a split tax. You know, I've lived in Reading for close to 30 years. We're finally getting it right, being pro-business. And I think you are being foolish in terms of thinking that this is actually going to be attractive to businesses. So as a resident, I'm totally opposed to this.
Thank you. Gary, certainly.
So Aaron, well, not just Aaron, everybody.
I don't want you to think that my comments about having a split tax rate means that me or anyone else on the board is anti-business. I mean, you can see what I've supported and what the board has supported just over the last 18, 24 months in terms of trying to change the zoning so that more people can live downtown. You can have more mixed use so more people work downtown, creating customers during the day, like when you said, when most of the people in Reading who live in Reading go to work elsewhere. At a time we're laying off potentially laying off police, firemen, and teachers, we dedicated a position that's going to basically try to make the pie bigger so that we don't have to have discussions about kind of carving up how we carve up the pie that we have, but maybe just creating the pie so that basically it rises all boats. I've been in support of that, as the board has been in support of that. But what drives sort of my desire to look at this is the fact that the same pressures that your stores and all the stores and all the good folks that are here, the time and a half on Sunday, the fact, and what you didn't bring up was the fact that Amazon, they don't have to pay sales tax, but when they walk into our stores, they have to do that. All of those things.
Amazon does pay.
Some of the bigger online. I think you get my point. All the retailers all across the Commonwealth are dealing with those same issues. But yet for me, what I can't get my arms around or wrap my head around is the fact that those towns are surviving with a larger tax rate on commercial than on residential. And so, you know, my thing is, why not us, and let's look at it. And if I can just make one more point, and maybe so we don't have to keep going through this every year. I think it was in 1993, and then again in maybe 2007, we created sort of an ad hoc committee that looked at property tax rates. Maybe it's a time to do that again, given that the changing economic conditions that have gone on. And I don't know if that was called by the Board of Selectmen, but again, and that was comprised of business community, residents, property owners, just looking at it, drilling down, you know, for example, to the things that, like, what would the impact of a shift be on a business that is, you know, valued at $500,000? Maybe it's time to kind of resurrect that again and do the due diligence. Because, you know, we've done a pretty good job of looking at this data. But maybe it's time to kind of reset that button again. I would certainly think it's a good thing to do to get more information better than less.
Dan?
Mr. Chair, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Keep in mind, too, in regards to which Melrose has Starbucks in the center, and that certainly is a draw. But there are smaller businesses that constantly turn over there, and the same with Wakefield, and the same with Winchester. So keep that in mind. When people look real quickly and they say, oh, this is great, this is thriving, you're not necessarily seeing the number of businesses that have gone in there, too.
Yes, Dan.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to read into the record the names of some folks who were kind enough to contact us by email. I don't think I see any of them here tonight, but sorry if I'm missing you here. In favor of a split tax rate, Angela Binda, Heidi Bonabau, and Anthony Bastiani. In favor of a residential factor of one, i.e. no split, Leslie Leahy of the Hitching Post, Sarah Blumenstock Jarrell of the Goddard School, Mark Beckley, Peg Rossidi, the Reading North Reading Chamber of Commerce, and Diane Manahan of Pamplemousse.
Okay. Any other public comment?
I have the list, Paula.
Yes.
Okay. Peter Sims Jules. Also, to be fair, Dan, I think you got quite a few letters during the summer from some of the residents. So I know I sent the letter myself.
You did. Yeah.
Just to the point that Erin got to, and I wanted to bring that up also, she's right. Last time I drove through Reading Square, we have vacancies. Last time I went through Wakefield, they have vacancies. We have another store in Winchester. They're constantly flipping businesses over there. They're not vacant, but they're in and out all the time. You know, it's a concern. You know, we're struggling. You know, all of us are struggling. We're trying to be good neighbors. We want to work with the town. And that's basically all I have to say. You know, I really agree with what Andy had to say. I mean, he said it beautifully. You know, we want to see what the problem is and see if we can and do it. But right now, you know, a tax increase would push a lot of us out of business. Thank you.
Yes.
Unless I had fallen asleep at this part, town meeting, I believe town meeting passed the senior relief with a full understanding of where that burden was going to lie. So I just want that to be correct.
That was pre-instructional motion. You are correct.
So I just want to be clear.
Yep.
That the town meeting passed that, clearly understanding where the burden was going to rest. Thank you.
Any other public comment? Anything from the board? And I'll entertain a motion to close the hearing.
Move to close the hearing.
Second.
All those in favor?
So do we want to go in order? How do you want to do this? Want to just?
We should just march through here.
March right down the list.
And, you know, so the next one on the agenda is whether or not the Board of Selectmen would grant or not grant an open space discount.
Just take them in order.
So I think we take those in order and understand, I mean, they're offered here in our material as a one way or the other.
So just, why don't we just say,
do you want me to stay for this or?
What?
Do you want me to stay for this?
We need Victor for this too.
No.
You're entirely welcome or you're entirely free to go?
You're entirely welcome to
leave.
With
our thanks.
It's your call.
He's dismissing me, but I thought I'd ask.
Sorry.
You did a good job.
You're fine. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Victor. Great job.
As always, very thorough and easy to follow. Thank you.
So why don't I just read it, grant, and then we can vote yes or no?
Barry, you know we're not going to vote that, so. Just make the motion the way you know we're going to vote.
Move that the Board of Selectmen not grant an open space discount for fiscal year 2017.
Second.
Is there a discussion? All those in favor?
Move that the Board of Selectmen not adopt a residential exemption for fiscal year 2017.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor? 5-0.
Someone want to make this other motion?
Move that the Board of Selectmen adopt a residential factor of 1 for fiscal year 2017.
Second.
Discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor? All those opposed? Vote is 4-1 in favor of a residential factor of 1.
Move that the Board of Selectmen not grant a commercial exemption for fiscal year 2017.
Second.
Discussion. All those in favor? 5-0.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Thanks.
There's plenty more if you want to stick around.
Yeah.
You don't have to go.
We're going
to
keep going.
But wait, there's more. Is that what you're saying?
But wait, there's more.
Yeah.
Okay, we've got to, I think we've got a housekeeping item here that we've got to take care of relative to the acreage at Oakland Road.
Yeah, and if I might, this is the same issue that came in front of the school committee, I don't know, 3 weeks ago when I was there. Town Council thought it was best that you also make the same motion to clear the fact that you're free and clear of this, so that when town meeting one day ultimately does decide on fixing the title, whether it's tomorrow through article revisited or another time, that there's no stone unturned. That the selectmen have declared it surplus, the school committee has declared it surplus. The article was written so that any board might be able to do that in case we uncovered someone that we didn't think of, like the rec committee or who knows what.
Great.
This is
We don't know what's ours.
This is two belts and two sets of suspenders, just in case.
Yeah. Say that again, Bear.
So, but we don't technically know what's ours and what's theirs.
We think we know, but the records at land court are not always consistent with what we think we know. So it's just best to restart it, just like always, when you're not sure, throw all the past out, restart it, say what you think. This is the same thing we're going to face with the liquor license.
Yes. Yeah.
So that it didn't matter that we did not vote on this before we brought it to the town meeting?
4 years ago, town council said you didn't have to because it's all ending up in your lap.
Mm-hmm. Anyway.
The town council says it's much better if you declare that it's surplus.
Bob, do you know if school committee did in fact motion? I heard Jean get up. I couldn't really hear what she was saying.
They did that because I was there that night.
Okay,
Bill
thank
Brown
you.
And I sat next to each other and had a nice conversation about it.
So this seems to me to be, for us, strictly a housekeeping
it
item.
It is. Absolutely.
And it prepares us for whatever town meeting is going to decide.
Right.
Relative to whose care and custody this property is going to be in, and what the ultimate disposition is of that. And that sounds like it's going to be a two-part story.
Had the article passed last night, it was fine that you did it afterwards, because it doesn't take effect till 7 days after town meeting.
Oh, yeah, that was in there. Okay.
Okay.
All right, move that the Board of Selectmen determine that the real property shown on, shown as Oakland Road parcel on a plan of land entitled Plan of Land, Oakland Road, Town of Reading, prepared by Town of Reading, Department of Public Works, Engineering Division, Jeffrey T. Zager, Director, Department of Public Works, Ryan Percival, PE, Town Engineer, dated September 13, 2016, is no longer required for municipal purposes.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? 5-0, Paul, in favor of that motion.
Before you move on, John, is there any discussion we need to have tonight, Bob, regards the substitute motions for Thursday night?
Can we talk about...
It's fine to say no.
No, because I didn't bring what Ray sent me. It's really a basic cookie-cutter thing.
Okay.
The charter prescribes how to handle this.
Okay.
It'll essentially be the same motion with the last clause eliminated, I believe, regarding the authorization to sell. Everything else will stay.
Seems odd to me that, you know, that we don't just amend the original motion, but it sounds like that's in a different...
There's no more... The motion is vacated.
Doesn't exist, right?
I got it.
It's vacated. It's like we're starting over. You can offer any motion you want.
But it has to be reconsidered.
Okay, Mr. Roberts, don't get mad.
I buy him books, I send him to school. Still he doesn't learn.
I'm sorry, Dan, I'm going to go in for another dose.
Sorry, Mr. Chairman.
The vote is vacated, or the motion is...
Motion, there is, it's a notification of the vote.
It never happened.
But the question is now null and void as well. You can't bring the same question back before. The original question could be amended on the floor to strike...
It's as if Article 16 is being brought up fresh and new.
So the same language that was in Article 15 will be brought up fresh and new. True?
The motion can be made under what was posted in the warrant report. But it has to be within the four corners of that motion.
But it is going to be
different.
You can't
expand the scope.
But you have to bring up new information, otherwise you just can't. You can't do it for the sake of getting a second chance.
You'll argue that under the reconsideration. I don't understand Alan's distress, but...
John, if I might just read what Ray said earlier. He's got a number of steps, and step four is, this is the amended motion that he has suggested. Move that the town vote to amend the pending motion for warrant Article 16 by striking the following words, quote,
That's fine.
And move that the town vote pursuant to Chapter 40, Section 3 of the Massachusetts General Laws to authorize the Board of Selectmen on behalf of the town to sell or otherwise dispose of said Oakland Road property under such terms as it may determine, unquote.
That's
so that whole portion is struck.
So one of us has to stand, because the motion will be on the floor, and somebody has to raise an amendment of that sort.
This becomes the default motion that we'll hand out to town meeting members, and we'll tell them that.
Okay.
They don't have to agree.
So it's not an amendment, it is the main motion.
It is then the main motion.
Right.
Now, should you five vote to agree with that? Probably.
All right.
But we didn't know we were going to have a Board of Selectmen meeting this early between town meeting sessions. It is your article, though.
It's probably a sound thing to take a vote.
I don't see a downside.
I don't see a downside.
I will move to adopt town council's substitute motion for Article 16, should reconsideration pass.
And then you could just send that forward that along to Paula.
Second.
Is it clear what he said? It was striking it all the way from...
Yeah, he's starting with whole cloth and he's backing it up.
So you're going to do your thing on the screen, strike it out, okay.
Can you send that to us?
I will, yeah.
And Mr. Barry has graciously offered to argue both motions for us.
Both motions, the original and the amendment.
The motion to reconsider.
Oh, okay, thank you.
And then, yes.
There is a second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? 5-0.
How do you want to proceed?
Here we are.
I hope I didn't forward anything inappropriate.
That was quick.
Here we are.
Quite all. Biggest career killer in the history of man.
Yeah, exactly.
We have the town manager evaluation left on the agenda.
Right. Well,
good job.
I want to do a...
good job.
yeah.
We like you.
Motion to adjourn.
The, Bob's review will be posted on the website if there are any questions.
Actually, the shortest review I ever got was don't spend it all in one place.
It was a public record as soon as it actually was emailed to all you guys. So
yeah.
It's out there. Why don't I just take any questions?
Go ahead.
Ask anybody for comments. Bob, it's been a good review. I like the new form. I think it was effective.
Have you had a chance to review it, Bob?
Oh, yeah.
Bob, you can still offer comments if you didn't have an opportunity.
I thought it was best, actually, after the discussion.
Sure.
When I conduct an evaluation, I think I speak for most department heads.
Okay.
The supervisor has a lot of comments, and then the employee only reacts to those comments after the fact.
Self-evaluation.
Yeah. Why don't we start with Mr. Arena? Do you have anything to amplify regarding your comments?
No. My notes stand as written.
I have nothing to modify otherwise. I just would add in, which was evident in my, I think reflected in my notes, that Bob has done another great, has had another great year. Leadership quality-wise, certainly right there at the top of the list for his attributes. So I'm going to leave it at that.
I think my commentary stands as it is. I echo the appreciation that I think we all have, Bob, for the job that you do. You do, you know, you work tirelessly.
More than 40 hours, will I?
Yeah. And the quality of your work is exemplary, in my opinion. And, you know, one of the things that I value so much is that you're willing to engage in a dialogue with us. It's not... I mean, you know, there's always an open give and take that goes on, and I know that you do that as you, you know, have occasion to visit with any one of us alone, but you certainly participate and really help us facilitate and organize our thoughts in here, and I genuinely appreciate that.
Just a couple of comments. Where I work, we have sort of a similar evaluation where the employee will sort of give a self-evaluation, and then the supervisor will comment on it. And I always give myself either meet standards or meet expectations or below, only because I have high expectations.
Yeah.
And so, you know, when I went through it, it would have been really easy to say exceed expectations, but we just have really high expectations, and so my grades might have been a little bit lower, but not to reflect the fact that we're not comparing you against other town managers. We're comparing you against yourself almost. Yeah. So, and that's why maybe I think, and that's how I do it for myself. And so, the way the grades look, it may just seem like we're just satisfied as opposed to really jazzed. But I think the comments are more of a real reflection. And just the one thing that I would just what everybody else said. I know you and I had a conversation once, and we talked about what keeps us up at night, right? and you know, just about running the town. And one of the things is that I just want to convey, at least for myself, and I know I'm probably talking for the rest of us, is that you have a good team of people here on the board, and that, you know, we're ready to all roll up our sleeves and dig in and do the work, and that you shouldn't necessarily feel that it's all on you. I just think that's an important point, that we are all in this together.
Thanks, Barry. I just wanted to emphasize that in part two, the employee core competencies, Bob did achieve 10 of 15 grades with majority of the board voting that he exceeded the standards. But on the other hand, I do agree somewhat with Barry in that performance evaluations that say you met the standard where I work. That was a high grade because you had a lot of expectations. And if you look at I'll leave this for the audience to read, there's a lot of definition on the core competencies, and some of those are pretty tough nuts. So to have met the standard, let alone exceed it, is I think a high compliment. And a well-deserved grade. Bob, one point I called out in my comments was, number one, your culture of trust, and I continue to really consider that remarkable that you built with the employees. That is going to stand us in good stead as we move through the FY18 budgeting. If that didn't exist, I'd be very concerned about where we're heading in the next couple of months, but I think we're going to get through this together with our employees. And also, you know, a simple thing like when you left the room because you lived on one of the unapproved roads and you didn't want to participate, I didn't think that was necessary, but that just spoke to your high ethical standards, even going above what was even reasonable. So a little thing like that can sometimes speak miles. And thank you for being with us. I hope we'll have you here for many more years.
Glad to still be here. The comment that stands out from what came in to me was if there was any one of the 15 areas that I would like to achieve sort of the highest grade, it's actually the one you've given me for ethics and standards.
Yep.
That's really what this job is transparency and communication. You know, and I'd have to say, if I were evaluating the board, I think you get the same grade. This is a remarkably open and transparent board. You can sit next to each other and yell and punch and fight.
No punch.
And that's yeah, that's
figuratively.
That's another town to our west. I won't mention that.
That was 20 years ago, Bob.
Because it's an open and honest discussion. It's not people sort of walking away later, not saying things and getting mad. And that's what happens in other communities, and it's not healthy. And, you know, that's what happens in other workplaces, and it's not healthy. If you have something to say, say it. And I think all six of us believe in that, and I think it's a good policy. But just thank you in general for your comments, and I'll certainly make some. I will say the hardest challenge we all face, it's something that's harder to measure. The paying class study measured pay. The thing that's really hard to measure is depth of staffing.
Yeah.
And the services that we offer from the depth of staffing we don't have are really high, and that's not sustainable.
Right.
That's the thing that does keep me up at night now, is I am perfectly fine and understand the vote for the voters of the override, but we cannot keep offering all the same services.
Right.
And, you know, I have had some discussions with a couple of department heads. I don't think two nights is enough for the budget in January.
Right.
Yeah.
Well,
I think that Jean might take a whole night and bring in all her boards, quite honestly, because there's going to be a lot of discussion. And we haven't even got to the point of knowing what things should be questioned, just we know that there are many of them.
One of the suggestions, and I'm not sure how feasible this is in our setting, but the zero-based budgeting is often talked about, where you kind of build the whole apple cart back up again, the building blocks of each department, what is truly essential.
Yep.
For the mission of that group, what is the next?
How do you right size the group? You start
given you have so many bucks.
And the same, we were also talked about having a similar conversation with the schools. At least, obviously, they're going to do what they're going to do, but
yes.
At least trying to encourage that same kind of thing.
I intend to raise that question when we interview the candidates. So, what's your philosophy toward that?
Yeah, I think one area that we can all improve on, and it doesn't really start with any of us, is we need to get the boards and committees in here more often.
Yeah.
You've seen them much more often than any other board of selectmen has in the past, but it's still not
enough. It isn't enough, you're right.
There's still boards and committees that are running off in a direction that none of us know about.
Right.
And
we
at the very
the
least, we need to know.
Housing board?
Yeah, I wish we had. Yeah. Wish we had
they're just not that much
them.
Under our control. That's the problem.
So, you know, we'll continue to work at that, and there's only so many nights that people can meet.
Right.
But, you know, when we have brought boards together, I'm going to ask you on the 29th to have the Permanent Building Committee, School Committee, Library Trustees, and yourself, and Bylaw Committee together. That's five. Now, I don't think it's necessary that the School Committee and Library Trustees come as a whole. They can just send one. I've already talked to John about this. I haven't talked to the library. It's to discuss the bylaw that creates the Permanent Building Committee and what's the expectation of the three elected boards. So they want to bring that in front of you before just running off to town meeting next April with an article.
Yeah.
You know, and that's the right thing to do. And the bylaw committee wants to sit there to listen.
Right. We want to do that on the 29th.
Yes, we want to do that on the 29th.
Which is when we're also meeting with
the school committee is here, so it's convenient.
Yeah.
Maybe do the school committee thing first.
Yes.
Good news is I think we'll be out of town meeting Monday. No.
Maybe. Right after.
Week from Monday.
Mike,
you know, the
Mike,
other thing that we haven't talked about it too. I mean, you know, right sizing the budget, starting from scratch. It's just, you know, and maybe we should have done this at the financial forum. At least start to throw open the ideas of, you know, are there other pockets of revenue that
too bad Mark left.
Yeah, pockets of revenue. You know, things that you know, we tossed out because, you know, but need to revisit. Do we look at fees again? Do we look at, you know, you name it. I mean, just there's 100 different things.
I think everything's on the table.
But to start to have those kind of discussions.
I want to maximize revenues from that new tower they want to build.
Love that idea.
Yeah.
But how do we get all the teams working together? I mean, the trouble with the spontaneous, a one-time meeting with the school committee is it's a little forced. There isn't the, you don't have a cadence to work on it. You got to get it done that night or that day. To the extent that the major boards in town need to work together, I don't mean to suggest yet another meeting, but it would be nice once a quarter or every couple of months to get together on a topic around budget and spending and cost down. Because otherwise we're working it independently, and I don't know, what's the board sense in that? It feels like we ought to be doing more as a group. We're 30% of the town spend, right?
Or maybe at least have subcommittees from, if that's not schedule-wise feasible.
That'd be fine. Subcommittees would be fine. I'm just saying there ought to be...
Sometimes more done in a working sense with subcommittees. Just my experience.
One of the issues, since I manage the room without Mr. Halsey sitting there, one of the issues we have as staff is we cannot physically attend all the meetings that happen.
Right, of course.
Right. So there's going to be things that happen that are a surprise, as we weren't there.
Mm-hmm.
It's impossible not to have that happen. I guess if we had a meeting of, you know, maybe we need to, you know, if you want, I can bring up in January a reorganization of boards. There's too many of them for the staff we have. It just is.
By the way, that's the first thing that downsizing or right-sizing has got to do is trimming that.
If you want me to take a whack at that, I will.
Sure.
We've sort of discussed it internally.
Aren't these boards in the bylaws or
some
in the charter?
Of them, you know, there's...
Bylaws, it's easy to...
Over the charter committees, you know, I objected putting so many in the charter.
Yeah.
Just because they exist doesn't mean you have to fill them.
Because that's got to go to the voters if you want to change
the... You don't have to fill any board that's in there. Well,
right.
There are certain state requirements. You have to have Board of Health.
Yeah. You have to have a constable.
And I don't want to call any out, but there are some that are in the charter that you do not need to populate.
The hardest decision for us is going to be what we don't do. And there's going to be hard decisions because you're trying to tear down an organization.
Right.
But we have marching orders.
Absolutely.
We have marching orders.
Absolutely. I'm not confused.
For at least 2 years.
This town.
And what I have done is zero-based committee. Start with no committees. Where do you start?
Right.
And I have done that.
That's
and it's interesting.
That's very interesting.
Yeah.
But a lot of these committees, you know, they're populated by volunteers who are excited about what they do, that provide value.
Right.
That, you know...
But they cost
probably
money.
Are
they do cost money.
It's the cost of value.
Yeah.
Nothing
cost
is free.
Cost benefit.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, I could think of a few, but I mean, you know, it's sort of...
A group of engaged citizens don't have to be an arm of you.
That's true.
They can
Some
be
of them
a,
have
they
to
have
be
many,
regulatory,
many ways,
no question.
They can be a group of citizens.
Right.
I mean, look...
Especially now, you want to encourage more of that, not less.
Well, you know...
You don't have to be a committee, and you don't have to have staff that are supporting them. That's the problem. We got to downsize.
You know, I mean, I was a regular visitor to this chamber.
No.
All right. And it was as a member of a private organization that was busy doing something. And, you know, we didn't need oversight. We didn't need staff. You know, and when we needed to do something that involved the town, we came here and talked about it. And, you know, sometimes I'd have to wait 3 months to get on the agenda, but that's okay. I mean, you know, you have to work with what you have. So, you know, and I do think that that's going to be a piece of the discussion as we start to try to execute the will of the people in this town that voted. They told us exactly what they want us to do. It's our job to figure out how to make that work.
Mr. Chair, I had a question or comment. Paula,
yes.
And I were talking before the meeting. Can you tell the board how many committees there are in the town that you live in?
There are six, and the town runs fine.
And how many and how many citizens are there in the town?
It's about 8,000.
So about a third of our size, but a dramatically different org structure.
Mm. Used to call
just a footnote. I thought it was humorous. So
before we had a town manager, they called it the Hydra. Because
I saw the photograph. I saw the picture. There was a picture drawn of
it. It had many arms and legs, but no head.
That's
so are we getting close to being able to send Paula home?
Yeah.
Sure.
We have a couple
minutes.
Here's
some minutes.
Let's move.
Move Board of Selectmen approve the minutes of October 13th, 2016 as amended.
Second.
Any discussion?
No.
Any amendments? All those in favor? 5-0.
Move the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes of October 25th, 2016 as amended.
Second.
Discussion? Amendments? All those in favor? I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Move that the Board of Selectmen adjourn the meeting at 10:53 p.m.
P.m.
All those in favor?
We stand adjourned. Do you have signatures tonight?